Listening to CFRN, a community of believers who trade for a living. To learn more about who we are, what we do, and how we do it, call toll-free 1-866-928-3310, and we'll send you out a no-obligation information kit absolutely free. 866-928-3310. The CFRN E-Mini Futures Cast is now on Stitcher. Listen to us on your iPhone, Android phones, BlackBerry, and WebOS phones. Stitcher is smart radio for your phone. Find it in your app store or at Stitcher.com. Stitcher Smart Radio, the smarter way to listen to radio.
Are you ready, Steve?
Uh-huh.
Andy?
Yeah!
Bert? Well, all right, fellas. Let's go!
You're listening to CFRN, the Christian Financial Radio Network.
Today's broadcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download at www.audibletrial.com/CFRN. Over 85,000 titles. Choose from mystery, romance, religion, science, technology, business, New York Times bestsellers, even children's books. You name it, Audible has it. With 85,000 titles to choose from, you're sure to find the perfect audiobook for yourself or to give as a gift, and it's absolutely free. Just point your browser to audibletrial.com/CFRN. That's audibletrial.com/CFRN. And become a part of the audiobook revolution by downloading your free audiobook today. audibletrial.com/CFRN.
Hey, trader, want to get rich quick? Well, good luck with that. If, on the other hand, you actually want to learn how to trade, the place to be is www.cfrn.net. Tune in Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. Eastern, for our daily devotional, and then spend the next 3 hours learning how it's done from professional traders who actually trade for a living. That's www.cfrn.net. Every trading day from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Eastern. CFRN, a community of believers who trade for a living.
Good afternoon, traders, and welcome back to the CFRN E-Mini Futures Cast. This is the daily broadcast of indeterminate length where we discuss all things E-Mini along with some really big ideas on the finer points of trading gold, bonds, crude, sugar, the euro, and even T-bills. Joining us today from our studios in Boston, Mr. Michael Borth. From our trading desk in Chicago, Mr. Burton Schlichter. And from our studios in Las Vegas, Nevada, Mr. David Williams. Now, to get things started, let's go to our host and founder in Studio A, overlooking South Mountain, America's largest city park. Here's Dwayne.
Hey, good afternoon. Welcome back. Today is Wednesday, 11th day of November, 2015. And I would like to extend a very happy Veterans Day to each and every one of you, to all of you who have served our nation. I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart and from everyone here at CFRN, and even from my own home and my own family. For those of you who courageously stood in the gap for freedom, I mean, freedoms that I'm ashamed to say sometimes as Americans we take for granted, our birthright. You know, in the lottery of life, you could have been born in Syria. You could have been born in Africa. And we have people in our audience today. I don't know for sure if there's anyone dialed in from Syria or Africa at the moment, but Interestingly enough, I was just on the phone with one of the representatives from one of our service providers, and he remarked, he said, in all my time in the business, I've never seen a company with a global audience as diverse and large as the one you have on a consistent daily basis. I said, wow, that's awesome. I said, maybe you guys should do a commercial and use us as your crash test dummy, and then we won't even charge you to be in the commercial. We'll just accept some services for a year or something. I don't know. How would that work? He laughed and said, ha, ha, ha. And then I promptly canceled some of my services that I didn't need. You know, you should always check your bills, your credit card statements, different things. Sometimes you might be paying for things you don't know you're paying for. Maybe you got a free deal a year ago, like there was, you know, a promotion. You know, sign here and you're going to get this and this and this for a year free. Well, all you hear is the free part. And you hear, I'm going to get it for a year free, right? What you don't hear, or what isn't said, perhaps, is that after a year, you're going to pay through the nose for that stuff. Okay. Well, make a note to yourself. And then when the year passes, you can make a judgment call. Do you want to keep it, not keep it? Just be aware of, you know, what you're spending and what you're spending it on. That's just all part of being a good steward, which will tie into our good word for the day in a unique way. And our good word for the day today, going to get some people squirming in their seat, a little uptight. Okay. I've never been the man on TV with the diamond ring. Remember that song from Dire Straits about the preacher man on the TV? I'll have to play it for you sometime. Anyway, back to the veterans. I just, again, want to say thank you. Now, I myself was in the military. I was blessed. There was no ongoing war or police action or whatever you might want to call it. I joined in 1977. Vietnam had just wound to a close. Richard Milhouse Nixon had brought our boys home. I believe that's how that played out. I was a kid. I was 17. I didn't know from politics about anything. I just knew that I wanted to get as far away from the little one-horse town I had grown up in as I could possibly get. And when I went to see the Navy recruiter, who got a little bit excited about the ASFAB scores, he said, son, you can write your own ticket. Where do you want to go? I said, as far as I can get from this town. And he had a globe on a stand by his desk. And this is actually what happened. He said, well, we're here. And he put his finger on Augusta, Georgia. He spun the globe and stuck his finger, looked down and said, how about Japan? And I said, sign me up. Boy, huh. That was the beginning of quite an adventure. I had it all mapped out. I was 17. I was going to be retired at 37. They were going to send me to college. So at 37, I was going to be the first person in my family, practically the first person in my town that ever went to college. I was going to be 37, retired, paycheck, health insurance, college degree. Man, I had it all mapped out. And it would have played out exactly like that if I hadn't been such a knucklehead. I graduated high school at 16. I wanted to go out on my own, but my mom wouldn't let me. She said, until you're 18, I'm legally responsible for you and blah, blah, blah. And so I went the military route. So she signed me away to the military. 4 days into boot camp. No, how about 4 hours into boot camp? I realized that there'd been a horrible mistake made, that I was just not cut out for this man's Navy. However, turns out when you stand in that room and raise your hand, that's a legally binding agreement. And son, you're in the Navy now. So I had to buckle down and get squared away and deal with stuff. But I messed it up. I went to the company commander in boot camp, and I said, hey, this isn't going to work for me. I signed up for 6 years. You guys are going to send me to college. I'm going to be an officer, blah, blah, blah. You know what? What's the soonest I can get out of here? And so they tried and tried to talk me into doing the right thing, but I would not listen. It's like when we tell people you got to use a hard stop, they don't listen. Just like when I was told to use a hard stop, I didn't listen. And so finally they said, all right, if you want to turn down a free education and all this stuff, you can be out in 4 years. And instead of coming in as an officer, you'll come in as an E3. And I said, okay. Yeah, I know. Right. So back to the veterans. Thank you guys for what you did. I served in a peacetime military. I admit, I wasn't a very good soldier, sailor, whatever. I respect my country, and I respect all the men and women who did put their lives on the line. You know, I just went from bar to bar, country to country. I learned a lot, and my son is considering ROTC and then the military, and I think that's a fine choice for a young man or a young woman. It teaches you so much about life. It teaches you organization and structure and just discipline, so many things. Now, no parent wants to see their child in harm's way. There are branches of the military where there is less of a chance that you'll be in front of a sniper's bullet. But when you sign up to serve your country, you are agreeing to put your life on the line. And so I salute all of you today, this Veterans Day, November the 11th, 2015. If you're new to the show, you should be able to see the chart I have up of the S&P 500 E-mini futures. If you cannot see the chart, go to our homepage at cfrn.net. On the right-hand side of the page, click the big microphone, follow the instructions. In about 30 seconds, you'll be registered not just for today, but all the way through the end of the month. Come 1st of December, we all register again. When you do it on the first day of the month, you're trading 30 seconds for 30 days. That's a pretty good deal. You'll even get a reminder email most days when the system's working properly that tells you, don't forget, the show starts at noon Eastern, and you can join us with one-click access. The debates were last night, so we'll talk about that later in the show. I'm interested to get your opinion. Along with being able to see the charts, you also have access to the chat box. Now, that's how you participate in the program. Questions, thoughts, ideas, complaints, whatever it might be. Just want to get it off your chest. Use the chat box. Just type it in. We'll answer it. We'll talk about it. If need be, we'll Google it. If we don't know the answer, we'll find it. Okay? It can be about trading. It can be about indicators. It can be about methodology. It can be about the $14.3 billion that was spent online today in China on what they call Singles Day. It's sort of their version of our Cyber Monday. We'll talk about that in depth. We got a lot to talk about today on this Veterans Day. But first, we're going to go to Michael for a recap of everything that happened today in the live trading room. The good, the bad, the stuff that got away. When he's finished, I'll be back with our good word for the day. Now, I promise you, it's going to tie some of you in a knot, and there's 4 days of it. It's a mini-series, okay? We're going to talk about tithing. I know, you don't want to hear about it, but you're going to if you stay tuned in. Now, I suppose you could turn down the volume during the good word for the day and turn up that Black Sabbath you got going in the background. You could do that, or listen, because I'm going to try to give you a unique perspective on something that makes people squirm, okay? All right, and then after the good word for the day, we'll take a look at our concierge trade alerts from last night. We'll head out to Vegas, talk to David from Page Trader, get his forecast from the edge. Today is Wednesday, and so my every Wednesday co-host, Jim Cox, will be joining us. That's Jim Whitebar Cox. He'll be joining us to tell us what's happened in his life over the past week and walk us through the trades that he took today. And we got a little something-something going on for those active partners who have been with us for at least 6 months. I'll tell you more about that later in the show. So all that and more, plus answers to your questions, coming up. Michael, take it away.
All right. Let me find. Here it is. That thing's still going. All right. There we go.
What thing?
I got it. The thing that I tried to do in the live trading room.
I didn't know you tried to do
half
something.
Half an hour ago. I just tried to bring up a page and.
Oh.
It didn't work out.
Okay.
All right.
I can see your screen, so I'm going to hit mute on my end.
Excellent. All right. With that, I will hit record. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Today is Wednesday, the 11th day of November 2015. Let's see. If you have not taken a free trial with us, go here to our homepage at CFRN.net. You can just click homepage there if you're not on the homepage. In the right-hand column where it says name, put in your name, where it says email, put in your email, then click register for a free trial. Once you click register for a free trial, you'll be sent a confirmation link. You must click the confirmation link, okay? Even though right now we don't get it, it's going to get fixed and we will eventually get it. Click register for a free trial and we'll get the confirmation link. Okay, once we get the confirmation link, we know you took the free trial, and then we can sign you up. Okay? We'll send you all the information you need to get into our live trading room. Not sign you up. We'll send you all the information you need. So let's go over our results now, okay? Our live trading room results. You've got to click there, and then click there, and scroll all the way down to the bottom. And see our results for today. Okay, today in the live trading room, we lost 12 ticks on the Russell. We made 30 ticks on crude, 5 ticks on gold. All right, so that put us up $230 a contract. Took us 14 minutes and 2 trades to get to our goal for the day, and we traded 13 times today. So on the month, we're now up $1,360 over 8 trading days, averaging $170. If you apply an $8 commission to every trade, you'd be up $176. If you applied a $5 commission to every trade, you'd be up $620. Over 8 trading days so far. On the year, today is our 212th trading day. We are up $56,687.50. That is a daily average of $267, $267 per day average. Okay, that's where we stand. So let's go over the actual trades now. Okay, the actual trades. Yes, and we'll start out with the gold. Okay, on the gold, we got 5 ticks profit. Right there, 1 trade, 5 ticks profit. That was it. You can see the whole day in gold right here. So, you know, it being a holiday for, you know, it's, you know, they're treating it as a pseudo holiday because the markets are still open. I believe the banks are probably closed. I'm not sure about that, but I know my kids were out of school today. But the markets are still open. So, even though I'm a veteran, I still have to work. The up close right here off the BBC was the trade that we took. We took 5 ticks profit on that. Okay. Oh, I know, John. That's only 2 weeks away. Thanksgiving is 2 weeks away. On the gold, this next trade right here was another up close off the BBC, but the cycle was red, so we needed to close above this trend line. Okay? So that was the second opportunity right in there. During the break, you couldn't really do anything during the break. There might have been one trade right here, but that was a momentum trade going into dynamic support, so I wouldn't have done it. Okay? That was it. Just 2 trades today in the gold. The NQ is just crazy, this little market. I'm gonna have to start looking into that. Maybe start trading it myself in the live trading room. All right, the Russell. What do we do with the Russell today? We're down 12 ticks on the Russell. Okay. Let's get all the way back here. Here we are. All right. So we didn't do anything right there at the very beginning. I guess I missed the first 5 minutes today. They're just on to me, John. Right here I shorted coming out of the weekly trading zone. I actually didn't. There was a short there coming out of the weekly trading zone where I could have taken some profit. Another one right there. I finally got one over here, and I got a break even on that. Over here, I had 3 ticks profit on this one, and 1 tick profit on that one, putting me at +4. Then I stopped out on this one, -8. That put me at -4. I missed this long trade, stopped out on this one, put me at -12, and that was where I ended the trading. Now look at this movement that it had right here during the break. Right, I stopped trading right about here, and then 10 minutes later, bang, there's a trade. Didn't do that yesterday. Anyway, there was a lot of opportunity during the break on the Russell, and the Russell ended with -12 ticks today. Crude oil. Let's scroll this baby back. This is where we made our money today. Okay. Our first trade on crude was right here. That is where we got our goal for the day. We took 10 ticks profit on that one. And the next trade on crude was right here. We took 5 ticks profit on that. Missed that one, and we took 9 ticks profit on this one, putting us at +24. Okay. 2 ticks over here, putting us at +26. 4 ticks there, getting us to 30. Then we had a break even there. Missed a trade there. And that was it. Let's see. This up close right here. Would have been a long trade during the break. This up close right in here would have also been a long trade during the break. This down close right here would have been a short trade, and this down close right here would have also been a short trade. Okay. If the current bar closes down, that would be a short trade. And that was it for the Russell today. We ended with -12 ticks on the Russell. Oops, that was crude oil. We were +30 ticks on crude. Oops. All right, on soybeans, we had just the one trade right here. We got a break even on that one. And on the ES, we had just one trade over here that we got a break even on. But look at the movement that this thing has had. Look at the NASDAQ. I swear, guys, I'm just going to have to start trading this thing, this NASDAQ. I'm going to have to replace something and get that in there. Then we'll have 3 indexes that we're trading. Maybe I'll replace an index. Anyway, on the ES, we didn't get any more trades. We just had the one trade in there. Okay. So back to here on the day. We were -12 on the Russell, +30 on crude oil, +5 on gold. It took us 14 minutes and 2 trades. I was actually 7 minutes late, so it really took 7 minutes. But 14 minutes and 2 trades to get to our goal for the day, which is $100 a contract. And we took a total of 13 trades on the month. We're up $1,360 per contract. $1,360 per contract. That's over 8 trading days, averaging $170 a day. On the year, we're up $56,687. That's over 212 trading days, averaging $267 a day. Okay. Now, if you have not taken our free trial, then you just need to go here to CFRN.net. And in the right-hand column where it says Register for a Free Trial, put in your name, put in your email, click on Register for a Free Trial, and you'll be sent the confirmation link. You must click the confirmation link, okay? If you don't click the confirmation link, you are not going to get the free trial. It's as simple as that, all right? Click the confirmation link and you get a free trial. All right. And that's all I got. That is all that I got. All right. Dwayne, if you're there, we can head back out to Phoenix. I'm going to shut the recording off. And if you're not there.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm here. Okay. Just give me a second to tidy up a couple things on my desktop.
Okay.
Alert. By the way, guys, the Russell continues to be at the top of the leaderboard as far as the one trade a days go. With one trade a days, you've got to understand some days you won't get triggered. That's going to happen. Of course, you know, some days you'll get stopped out. That's the truth about trading. And there'll be all, you know, variations in between. On the concierge alerts, because they, just because of the nature of when they come out, it's rare we don't trigger on the concierge alerts. Now, it's happened a number of days in a row with gold, and that's a whole other story we'll talk about in a few minutes. But the leaderboard, because people keep saying, hey, I want to do the one trade a day. Which one's been giving the best results? So far, the best results have come from the Russell. But we all know that past performance is what, Michael?
Well, it's not indicative of future results.
That's right. What he said, it's history.
What is it?
It is old news. You can wrap yesterday's or today's fish in it. I don't know. Something like that.
any fish.
any fish. Just put the fish. Get that fish out of here. Just
put the fish in it.
All right. And so let me make a little note here. 11. Last night, the concierge alert on the Russell. The reason I brought up the Russell is because I was actually highlighting that chart. Short below 82. Oh, man. So let me just go ahead and take the charts.
Okay.
And there. Okay. Here's what I was working on, guys. There's a lot. This looks like one of those Mrs. Bronner's or Mr. Bronner's. One of those amino. Some of you know what I'm talking about. It's the health food stuff in the yellow bottle with the label that has all the writing on it. And it's like really small, and it's just the whole label's covered, and some of it's turned sideways, and it's... you know what? It's worthy of a... This is a photo opportunity. That's what this is. How do I want to do this? Let me go... New window. And... Bronner's. Amino... I'll just go with soap, because I saw soap pop up. Bronner's soap. Yes, okay. We're going to blow up this bottle. I've had this very bottle in my home over the years. Let's see if we can blow that thing up. Okay. I don't know how well you guys can see that. You see that little bitty writing? It's all over it. It's here, and it's over here. And it's here, and it's all around the back. And all of the Bronner's products are like that by somebody who was, I don't know, they just took advantage of every available inch of space on this label to tell you about their products. And they are good products, I will say that. All kidding aside, they are really good, healthy products from soap to amino acids and all kinds of stuff. But anyway, back to the Russell. I was saying it's at the top of the leaderboard for the one trade a day. It's no slouch in the concierge trade alert department either. Last night, we had said to be long above 89. And if you did that, the swing high was 91.7. And so that'll put some starch in your shirt. And we also said to be short below 1182, which would be right there. Yeah, right there. almost. There we go. And the swing low on that was 77.50. So that's going to be about 4.5 points. So if you got out at the very last tick, which you didn't, that would be $450 per contract. Now, let's take a look at the volume, okay? The volume. 12,000 contracts traded in this candle. So could you have eased in there with 10 or 20 contracts? Yep. Might you have gotten slipped on a couple of the contracts, a tick here or there, coming in, going out? Yep. Even though there's that many contracts being traded, 12,716, when you look at the DOM, at the bid and the ask, you know, there might be, you know, 10,000 on the bid side, but in the first position, there might just be two or four or six or eight. And so once you get up to 10 and 20 contracts, you have to accept the fact that even if it's the S&P, the most liquid contract in the world, there'll still be a little bit of slippage. It's just part of the business. It's kind of like getting stopped out. It's just part of the truth about trading. And so don't worry about that now. The first thing you want to be concerned with, the only thing you want to be concerned with at this point, if you're not already there, is becoming consistently profitable. Okay? That's the... You got to learn how to make $100 per contract per day. You're only going to work with one contract, and that's your focus. And when you move to two contracts, guess what your job description will be? Make $100 a day. And when you graduate to three, when you earn your way to three contracts, your job description, make $100 a day. Well, no, Dwayne, do the math. That's 300. Yeah, I know. Let the back office take care of that. You just focus on making, from now, for the rest of your life, you're going to wake up each day and go make $100. Write that on the tablet of your heart. Engrave it on the walls of your mind. Let it become your very existence. That's what, when people say, what do you do for a living? Yeah, I make $100 a day. And they go, no, seriously, what do you do? Yeah, I make $100 a day. It'll be a great opener at your next cocktail party. You'll beat out the guy with the lampshade on his head. Okay, I kind of jumped the gun on the Russell thing, but just to show you, we did have a good night with the Russell. Also, the free trade Sunday night was the Russell, and that was awesome. It went 18 points. We said to be short on the free trade, consider being short, below 1195. And so that's 1194.9, and it dropped 18 points at $100 per contract, $100 per point per contract. The potential was $1,800. Now, none of us got out at the exact swing low, because that's just weird. What happens is you get stopped out with profit on the way down when it draws back like this. Where you get stopped out depends upon how closely you trail your stop. Now, Michael, what was the recap of the recap today?
Two trades, 14 minutes, $100 a contract.
Two trades, 14 minutes, and what?
$100 per contract.
Okay, so you nailed it right on the head. Okay.
I did.
Now, we record that every day, guys, and it's not to brag or boast. It's to make a point or a statement, if you will, that the old saw that everyone always tossed about, if a guy could just figure out how to make 2 points a day on the S&P because it's so liquid, then he would never have to worry about anything else again. Well, guess what? We've been doing that now almost every day for almost 3 years. Except we don't always do it in the S&P. Some days we do it in the Russell. Some days crude. Some days gold. Some days a combination. But guess what? I still worry about stuff. So the part about once you learn how to make 2 points a day or the equivalent thereof, you'll never have to worry about anything else. That's not true. I mean, the part about making 2 points a day and That turns into a lot of money as you multiply the number of contracts that you earn the right to trade. That's all true. But other stuff in your life is still going to come up. You know, friends and loved ones are going to get sick. I went to see my ex-brother-in-law last night. What a history we have. He's near and dear to my heart. But we've had our outs over the years. It's been a volatile relationship. Unfortunately, he's sick now, very sick. And he was the guy that always beat the odds, always came back. And this time, we're not giving up. We're just believing for a miracle. But life's fragile. And so while the markets are cool and making money's cool and getting good at trading, developing your skill set, all that's, it's good and more good, right? Don't forget about the other part of your life that needs your attention, your family and life itself, right? Our days on this earth are numbered. Don't want to bring anybody down. Don't want to harsh or mellow, but, you know, I opened the show talking about the veterans, those who gave their life for the freedoms that you and I enjoy. Let's not trash that. Let's be grateful. Let's have grateful hearts. Okay. So every day we record how long it takes, how many trades, so that it's not just a dream or a fantasy or wouldn't it be nice? It's a reality. You can go to our website. You can download our spreadsheet. You can take a look at every trade we've taken every day for almost 3 years. In the live trading room. Now, if we don't take the trade in the live trading room in front of a live audience, we don't put it on the spreadsheet. So what you're seeing is just a two-hour window into what goes on here, a two-hour window from 9:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Monday through Friday. The worst thing you can possibly do is become a partner and try to earn a living by matching Michael click for click. It will frustrate you and aggravate you. Why? Well, these are fast-moving markets. We're using a range chart, and not an eight-tick, not a four-tick chart, which would be too fast to trade, but a four-tick range chart. And so if Michael says, based on what the indicators are telling us, if he says, I'm going to be getting long the S&P on an up close at 2088, right? It may be, you know, a few seconds. It could be a minute when he clicks to make the entry. Now, you might have time to find your mouse. You might have time to get your S&P chart pulled up. You might have time to get your DOM open. And you might be able to get the exact same entry. You might, but then again, you might not. And if you don't get the exact entry, then you'll have to go through this mental debate. Should I get in late? You know, do I try for a better entry? You know, here's the best advice I can give you. Watch, listen, ask questions, and learn for 2 hours. If your mind is occupied with chasing his mouse, you're not learning anything, okay? You're just getting yourself frustrated. Instead, put the mouse away. Watch, listen, learn. Ask lots of questions. And then when the live trading room is done for the day, now I'm speaking to partners. I'm speaking to people on a trial. I'm speaking to everybody. Those who are thinking about learning how to trade, okay? You now have 22 hours to climb into the simulator with real data in real time and practice putting on and taking off trades using our indicators and the methodology that Michael teaches you each morning. When you no longer have the sound of his voice coming through your headphones or over your computer speakers, it's amazing how quickly you feel lost. Because you're so used to his voice guiding you and helping you navigate. Now, in the absence of his voice, you suddenly realize what you don't know. And that's important. Start making a list every day as you practice of what you don't know. Because the next morning, when the teacher shows up, you can ask what you don't know, get the answer, write it down, write it on paper, write it on the tablet of your heart, and then it will be yours forever. You own that. Once you learn it, no man can ever take it away from you. Okay? So that's really important. Now, we only use two trades in the live trading room. We use the slingshot and the momentum trade. That's what I call them. But there's two distinctly different trades. But that's it. That's all we use in the live trading room. Once you learn those two, I'm telling you, that's sufficient to make $100 per contract per day. It is. You may not do it in two trades. You may not do it in four. In fact, our blueprint allows you the luxury of 10 trades per day to make $100. And immediately everybody goes, oh, well, come on. If you're going to take 10 trades to make $100, there's no way you're going to end up being a successful professional trader. I beg to differ. You and I need to go mano a mano, one-on-one, ladies invited to, in a mentoring session, and I'll show you how that works out. You see, it's that very thing right there that separates the 90% from the 10%. There really is a 90% line of those who tried and didn't make the cut, and then there's a 10% line of those who not only survived the cut, but they are now thriving. See, life shouldn't be about surviving. It should be about thriving. And if you'll do the work, it's amazing. Later, I'm going to talk with Jim, and we're going to talk about an interesting study in human nature. But, funny you should ask, we had a test group of six people, or they call that a focus group. Turns out 5 out of 6 had not written their business plan or their trading plan. They were honest about that, and I really appreciate the honesty. And I say to everyone, partner or those looking to become a partner, you have to do the work. The markets are not just going to cut checks and stuff them in your pocket. You actually got to do the work. You got to read the blueprint and understand it. Then you got to sit down and write your business plan, write your trading plan, and then you have to, once you plan your trade, yep, you got to trade your plan. All right, let's go to our good word for the day. Told you this one's going to make you squirm. It's about tithing. Yep, bad figures. First day I tune into this radio show, and already that guy's trying to get my money. I don't need your money. Well, I could always use it. If you want to send some money, go ahead, but that's not my point. My point is Leviticus 27:30. A tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord. If you put your mortgage before your gifts to God, you show more gratitude to your bank than you do to the one who created you. You say, I earned it, so I own it. Well, the Bible says that's not true. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. That's Psalm 24:1. The earth is the Lord's. He created it and everything in it. All good gifts do come from the Father of lights. And so whatever it is that we have or possess in this life, according to the word, it's not ours, it's his. We have simply been given stewardship over it. God owns every square meter of land on earth and every person who walks on it. That includes you, even if you don't believe it. It includes you. You're not an owner, you are a steward. And while a good steward deserves to be well rewarded by his master, his first priority is to please him and carry out his will. The Bible says that a tithe of everything belongs to the Lord. So we've got to get our thinking straight on this issue. You know, instead of a mentality of, man, I got to give 10%. How about I get to keep 90%? That's pretty awesome, I think. In God's eyes, 10% of your income is dedicated funds to be used for one thing and one thing alone, His purpose on this earth. Now, a lot of people get confused with, do I tithe on the gross or the net before or after taxes? Well, you know what? If you want a gross blessing, go for it. If you want a net blessing, go for it. That's something that, you know, you'll figure out, okay? Gross or net. You figure that out, okay? Now, tithing isn't how the church raises its budget. It's how God raises his children. We distort God's word when we teach tithing as a means of getting money to pay off church debt or as a substitute for other worn-out methods of fundraising or as a cure for the church's financial shortfalls. The Bible says, son, daughter, give me your heart. It's Proverbs 23:26. Give me your heart and let your eyes delight in my ways. When God has your heart's deepest affection, you'll give gladly, not grudgingly. The first man in Scripture to tithe was Abraham. Why did he do it? Gratitude. The very thing I spoke about as we opened the show today. The same gratitude that we have to those who gave their lives for the freedoms that we enjoy. We show our gratitude to God for the many blessings that we enjoy. Because God had, now in Abraham's case, God had delivered him from the hand of an enemy who was out to destroy him. Sound familiar? You may not know it, or you may not believe it, but there is an enemy, and he is out to destroy you. Let me ask you a question. Has God delivered you in some way? Has there been a point or a time in your life when God himself stood in the gap, and it was unmistakably him? Couldn't have been chance or happenstance or a coinky-dink. It was him, the creator, the author of life, the finisher of our faith. That gratitude should swell up inside of you. And it has to come out somewhere. Has God blessed you? If he has, if he's delivered you, if he's blessed you, then you'll show your gratitude by being obedient to his word, not grudgingly. One of the scriptures, one of the translations says that God loves a hilarious giver. Now, there's an expression, drunken sailor. I don't know how many of you know what a drunken sailor is, but if you were ever in the military or maybe in the Navy, you probably have a pretty good idea. You've been out to sea for 90 days. You haven't seen wine, women, or song. Actually, there's music, but there's no wine or women. You come in, you pull into port after 90 days. Now, you're out at sea, you can't spend any money. You can buy a little bit of stuff in the ship store, but not much. You got money, and you've got liberty. And so you hit the town, and if you're a young man, from a small town in Georgia, you just might go wild. And you might have a little too much to drink. And you might start throwing your money around like you were Howard Hughes or Warren Buffett. Drunken sailor. Now, in that scripture translation where it says God loves a hilarious giver, see, when that sailor is all lit up and throwing his money around, he's not worried about the money. He knows he's got a job. He's going to go back to the ship tomorrow. He's going to get paid again in 2 weeks. I think we used to get paid every 2 weeks. 2 weeks or once every 30 days, whatever it was. There's security, right? And so we have that same security in God. We know that he's going to meet our needs. Jesus said, I'll meet your needs according to my Father's riches and glory. That's a promise. It's written in red in your red letter edition. So I want you to think about that. I want you to get happy. We're going to talk about this three more times, all right? And then we'll put it away for a couple years. And that's our good word for the day. All right, let's go to the charts. We got 7 minutes to Vegas. So we're going to get through as many of these concierge trade alerts as we can. Let's start out with the S&P 500 Emini Futures, which would be right about here. Okay. These are still last week's weekly trading zones. You can see that they're still doing a fine job. Look how we caught the top, the swing high today. At 2086/87, we consolidated nicely there for 2 hours. And then we made the trip back down, but we got short-circuited here on the way down. And we'll talk about that later. If we look left, you see this? Yeah, that's an area. Okay. So what do we have on our hands right now? We've got a leg and a retracement. Are we going to see another leg, which takes us to 64.65? Or are we going to go up to 86.87? Now, those of you who watched the recap video that I did last night, I did it kind of late. I did the concierge alerts in the afternoon, I think, and I did the one trade a day recap video late when I came back from the hospital. So I said on that video, if you go watch the recap video in one of the two, the one I was talking about the zones in, honestly, I forget which. You should watch them both. They're both good. But I clearly divided them. One is the concierge alerts. The other is the one trade a day. Now, I said there are very few absolutes in the world of trading. I said, but I absolutely assure you that price is going to go to 2086/87, or it's going to go to 64/65. And it went to 86.87 at 7 a.m. Eastern this morning. Okay. Now we're right back where we were last night when I was doing the video. Right back at the zone. So can I say the same thing with certainty? I can. Price is either going to go to 86.87 or it's going to go to 64.65. And if it doesn't make it to 64.65, it's going to at least try. And if it doesn't go to 86.87, it's going to at least try. And in that attempt, there will be room for me, in most cases, and you, to grab our 2 points for the day. So long above 84, this first move would have stopped you out. The next move would have given you a handy 3-point reward. We only need 2 points to be done for the day, $100 per contract per day. We also said to consider being short below 2072. And this is what it looks like when it comes out to the clients, to the partners. If you get short at 72, swing low was 69.50. So that would be 2.5 points. a stop out, a 3-point move, a 2.5-point move. Okay? All right. Bonds today were closed for Veterans Day. Now, when they said they were going to be closed, I thought they really meant they were going to be closed. But as you can see, there was some movement. So apparently, bonds opened last night for trading. And then they shut them down, I guess, at 12:30. I don't think they're trading. I know I read that somewhere. Anybody that in the audience that wants to clarify, clear that up for me. I'm always ready to learn. let's see here. Let's see. Okay, just checking to see if there's any questions. All right. Next, after bonds, would be crude oil. We said to consider being short below 43.50. The first move down took us to 43.43. That's a 7-tick drop. The next move took us down to 42.83. So that would be 67 cents off the top of my head. And you got to drop it down a tick. So I'm thinking it's 66 ticks. Why don't I make sure? 43.50 minus 42.83. Okay, I messed that up pretty good. Who can't run a calculator? Me, I guess. 43.50 minus 42.83. Ah. 67 ticks. Minus 1 because we drop it a tick so that we can get short below 43.50. Now, who got out with 66 ticks? Don't raise your hand because nobody probably did. What happened is you got your goal for the day, and if you're trading multiple contracts, and even some who are trading just one contract, once you lock in that goal for the day, you'll go ahead and trail that stop. And so when it pulled back here, maybe that's where you got stopped out with your profit. Maybe when it pulled back here, or maybe even when it pulled back here, maybe you're getting stopped out right here, right now. Okay. Wherever you got stopped out, congratulations, you did good. We're going to go to David right now at PageTrader for a little conversation, and we're going to go straight to the markets today. So, don't go away. Don't touch your radio dial. We'll be right back.
You're listening to CFRN, a community of believers who trade for a living. To learn more about who we are, what we do, and how we do it, call toll-free 1-866-928-3310. And we'll send you a no-obligation information kit absolutely free. 866-928-3310.
Returning visitor.
You said we don't need you now, be on your way. I thank the Lord for love that ours and grows ever stronger. And I always do. I know you feel that same way too. Oh, I...
Good morning, Dwayne.
Hey, David. Good morning. Welcome to the show.
Thanks very much. It's a real pleasure to be here.
We said today that we would go straight to the market so we have a chance to get them all covered. And then once we do that, we can talk about last night's debate if you'd like to.
However you'd like to go is fine. I just like to have enough time to get into some of the discussion about the market.
Absolutely.
And so on.
Let's start there. Let's make it a point to start with the markets, and then if we have any leftover time, we'll talk about the headlines of the day.
Okay.
So the S&P 500, we currently are sitting inside of one of our weekly trading zones from last week, 2079/2080. I've already covered my part of it, so take it away.
Well, let's see. To begin with, you know, the S&P larger, longer term, we feel is putting in a yearly top, and that yearly top would get printed at the end of this year. So we have a month and a half or so left before. Can you imagine we're a month and a half away from just completely being done with the year 2015?
Hard to imagine.
This has to be frightening for people who don't like to age, because the year went pretty quick.
Yeah.
So, anyway, we had been yesterday. Our forecast for the S&P was that the market was going to be putting in a bottom between. We were expecting to see hourly closes at or above 2067, and if they did that, then we would buy the market from 2067 or whatever the hourly close was. For an advance to two important targets on the upside. The first one we expected to get completed yesterday, which was 2078, and that was completed yesterday. And the second one was due today, and that was 2086/87. That was completed today. So both of those, this was essentially a 20-point move. We didn't get all 20 points, but we got most of them. Because the market tested the 2067 level several times for several hours and gave us a number of opportunities to get in with a relatively small risk, because the market would have to close, you know, hourly probably below 2062, let's say, in order to really, you know, concern us about that move. So probably about a 5 to 6 point risk in that trade. We sometimes use larger stops than that, but you know, our focus is on the probability of the trade, and therefore the importance of the static risk of the stop is not so important to us, because if we've done our homework correctly, and if anybody has done their homework correctly, it's much better to you know, have a high probability setup in front of you than just you know, taking shots at the market and so on. So anyway, so they completed that today. We have a new forecast for the market as well, and that had to do with the market getting down to 2071.72 in today's early session, which they've done. And the completion of those levels, we think, I'm not going to give out the whole trade because that's something we just gave out today to our followers and so on, but we think that that's bullish. So as long as we're above, I mean, roughly speaking, as long as we're above 2070, we like the idea of looking for buy signals in the market. That's what we think is likely the smart thing to do. I think at this point, if we were to get below 2070, we think that that would probably, you know, change the outlook. So we did take a long position a little bit earlier and took some off basically from around 2073, took some off at 2077, and we're at 2079 right now. We're waiting to see if we can continue to hold this through, you know, actually this would be an overnight position, just like last night's trade was. But I'm liking what I'm seeing in the S&P, and excuse me, I like the fact that the market is still, I think, at one level feigning or, you know, faking strength. So that's how we're viewing this.
That's
because we do have a lot
take.
Of important. Yeah, because we do. And listen, we're open to anything. You know, if the market shows us something that really confirms that the market has real strength in it, we're going to tend to want to trade that. And people do get themselves in trouble, and I do all the time, getting a bias on the market,
right,
and having
right.
a outlook that's very powerfully connected emotionally, and I'm ready to, you know, dive in on that. And if they do show me something else, it's an emotional skill to be able to, you know, stop and reverse in your mind and say, mm-hmm. no, actually, we have to take this other trade and or very seriously consider getting in to that trade. So it's interesting. A lot of what traders have to learn to do is based on emotions. Men are not as comfortable with their emotions. They, you know, tend to bury them and hide them. But to be emotionally or to be sensitive in a sense to your own emotions and be aware of what's really going inside of you is very helpful in trading. It can really help have an honest approach, honest not to other people, but honest to yourself. And many of us are, if you're honest, if you can be honest, you're not honest with yourselves. Many of us dream up personas mm-hmm. that we believe are being, that's who we, you know, that's what people see, but people see something quite different than that. And when people describe to you what they see, you think they're telling you about somebody else. And the habit of describing our own persona to ourselves is a bad habit, you know, about who we are to other people, constantly looking for affirmation. I would suggest to people who are constantly looking for affirmation that that's all you're doing. If you're hooked on that, that's a drug. If you need to tell people how much money you make, if you need to tell people how many people you help, if you need to tell people how religious you are, if you need to tell people, you know, you add in the fill in the blanks. If that's something you need to do, it's a drug that you need to get off of, because what that does is it interferes with every other part of your life, and it builds a internal persona that I can guarantee you is very different than what other people are seeing when they talk and interact with you. And this leads to a lot of surprise, like, well, why would you say that? Oh, you know, I'm not that way. I, you know, but yes, you are that way, and people can see it. So, you know, we all go through this. No one's talking down. I've been through this myself on a number of occasions, and I try to keep myself, you know, again, the word honest to myself. I don't even have to be honest to other people. Just be honest with your own emotions. If you're not ready for that yet, practice it, work it. Because in the markets, you have to be honest. You're just going to have to be. You can't
fool
yourself.
You have to be able to trust yourself. Whether you trust other people or not, that's another story. But if you're going to succeed as a trader, if you're going to succeed in life, you have to be able to trust yourself, first and foremost. Because so many people have painted themselves into a corner by doing all of the things you just talked about, where they can't trust themselves. And that's a lonely place to be. That's a desert island I don't want to be on, where I can't trust myself. So, well said.
So ultimately, we're looking at the S&P with, we have some time really left between now and when we think higher prices are going to be there. But I think it's important that the market maintain the 2070 level. If they don't, then we'll probably change our outlook for the S&P. So that's what got me onto this, is that we are tentatively bullish here, and we've seen a nice bounce off of our initial entry. We're going to see if we can maintain for higher prices here. So that's basically our initial outlook here for today. And this would take us, you know, we could we can update this tomorrow, you know, as the market continues to show its hand, and we're collecting information like all of us are. Every minute the market's trading, you're collecting more information about your outlook and about the positioning of the market and so on. And you know, try to not repeat mistakes. If there's a sin in trading, it's the sin of it's okay to make a mistake, but try not to repeat. I mean, sincerely, try not to repeat and go over old ground. You know, mistakes that you've already made that you already know are wrong. That's a lot of what traders end up doing, because, again, emotions become involved. And partly being honest with your own emotions allows you to diffuse them. They don't act so powerfully when you aren't resisting them and you're not fighting them and so on. It's like, you ever been to a movie where it's really sad and you know your wife or your girlfriend is crying, and, you know, what's a guy's first thing he's going to do? Well, I'm going to show that I'm not crying. I'm going to, you know, I'm going to show that it doesn't affect me. Well, that's dishonest, because you wouldn't say that if it actually wasn't affecting you. You wouldn't be trying to convince yourself. So it's that kind of honesty to ourselves that we're talking about, and that helps in trading. It helps in understanding your position in the market. So, and what you should do and what you can do and so on. The markets demand a kind of integrity. And they also demand intelligence. You're not going to get away with, you know, some little baby step thing in the market. You have to have some intelligence to trade these markets and make money. If that's what you're trying to do, if this isn't just a hobby, the markets pretty much demand intelligence in order to trade effectively. And intelligence means that you make connections between where they are now, where they've been in the past. You can envision moves in the future to some degree or another, and whatever methodology you're using is tied in with all that. You know, making connections is intelligence. And all the different things the market does from day to day, you know, whatever they did today, they'll never repeat again in a million years. The markets are absolutely different every day. And people do, there is a form of technical analysis where they look for tops and bottoms and, you know, long wave moves to kind of occur the same way they did last time, which is maybe 100 years ago, like in the year 2030. What do you think people are going to be saying in 2029? They're going to be looking for the market to basically crash in 2029 because it did 100 years ago. It crashed 100 years ago in the year 2000, in the year 1929. Now, there certainly can be large moves that occur on these repeating dates and so on.
Seasonal, some people refer to it as, yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of a form of a seasonal, but seasonals are a little bit more seasonal in the sense that, you know, they're really looking, the real true term of seasonality means that
right.
in a given season, in a given quarter, the markets do this and do that. But in generally speaking, yes, that is correct. And that can be useful, but I really can't think of using that as a leading main indicator. That can't be your main squeeze, you know, in getting the position right and you know, getting your position on
if
and so on.
If my methodology tells me to go long or short, longer term, and I happen to glance over and see that the seasonals match up with that, well, then that's just a little, you know, a little gravy on my potatoes. It's not the meat and potatoes. It's not why
right.
I'm putting the trade on. It's a little maybe added confirmation. Maybe I have a little additional confidence now because my work said this, and now I look over here and realize that a whole bunch of people are going to be taking that very trade or something similar based off of the trader's almanac or whatever it is that they use to get these seasonal trades from. So.
Yeah, so seasonality, you can use it. I actually, many years ago, you may have remembered a thing called the Delta Phenomena. Some of you may have heard of that. and it's kind of a, they don't really put it out there. It's not really a seasonal study, but it kind of is a seasonal study in its own way, but it's broken down to more minute levels. And again, it has all the discrepancies and slop that comes with seasonality in trading. So you have to be very careful with it. If seasonality says that oil is going to make a high in, you know, late September every year, you know, I'm just throwing this out there, whatever it is, you have to realize that that could be as much as 2 months off. I mean, that's a big window of time
mm-hmm.
for a lot of things to happen. So you have to have something else to polish that picture down. And there's many other ways that you can deal with it, but it's not bad. It's not bad to have some idea of seasonality in all markets, including the S&P to any other market, could be laid out in such a way that you could make an argument for seasonality in these markets. Most people think of seasonality with things that grow in the earth, you know, plants, soybeans, corn, so on. But seasonality exists in the stock indices and
mm-hmm.
so on.
Indeed. Ed W. poses a question. Dwayne, gold and crude have been very weak and, at least in my opinion, are at critical levels. Does David have any insights on either market?
Well, I can tell you a couple things about gold. First of all, the move that we've had down is an amazing decline considering where we were. Just in mid-October, we were up at 1190, and that was a number that we had forecast for a huge 80-point advance. But I had even complained then, we did not call this decline, but we had complained that if the market really was going to go higher, we would have liked to have seen a little more frothy behavior up at 1190, and we didn't see that. Ultimately, it led to a very powerful decline, and the market is attempting to break through some pretty important levels here. So certainly I'm not interested in the long side of gold as yet. I really shy away from the cheaper, more expensive view of markets, like, well, the gold is cheaper now. The whole premise that cheap and expensive, I don't know that that's really a good way to necessarily think about the market. The market is needs to be bought when it has expended the energy in the move on the way down. And if you can determine when that energy has been expended, it's ready to be bought. I mean, I guess that's a that's axiomatic, but I don't know that it would be wise to say, well, you know, they were up at $11.90 and they're now $100 cheaper, so I should buy it. I'm not sure that's a good way to go in.
I agree, because whatever today's price is, and at the moment it's $10.84.80, that's on the gold futures for the December contract, it's neither cheap or expensive. That's simply what it costs today. Right now, at this moment in time, that's what it costs.
Yeah, and the market can and often will go much further in a direction. So you want to avoid that thinking. Just, you know, just keep an eye on that if you're a person who thinks in terms of cheaper and more expensive. When you get to technical analysis, I think you have to view the market more technically, and it is cheaper. It is $100 cheaper, but that doesn't mean it can't go another $100 down. Not that we're forecasting that, but it certainly doesn't mean that the market needs to stop. You need to find other reasons for the market to stop and firm up on some important level and so on. So we're flat in gold right now. And I have been surprised by the depth of this move. They really, really poured it on immediately. We might have been able to expect this move a little bit later on the downside, but the amount of time that it took for them to reach 1190 and then just reverse was very short, and really probably too short for us to have been able to do something with it and really believe in the trade and stay with it. So we're flat in gold, and we're waiting to see a little more evidence. And that's where we are. I think that's a good way of putting it, is we're basically you know, collecting evidence on gold right now to see if there's something more we can do. But I can tell you that I think you should be cautious on the long side here. I think we'll have more clarity to it. And that's what, again, as I've said this so many times, what we're looking for. You know, we don't, our particular approach, we don't care about money in the sense of on a per day or per week or per any time frame basis. We're looking for probability. We're looking for a very high probability that a very specific thing is going to happen. And if we can find that, then we're going to still try to trade that with the least amount of risk that we can. And a lot of the risk is not, people make the mistake of thinking that the risk you have is the dollar amount that your stop is, because it's very common to say, well, we're risking, you know, whatever your, you know, 8 ticks, 5 points, whatever it is. That's what how people think of their risk. I don't think of the risk that way. I think of the risk of the trade being correct. And I, in other words, if the trade, if I've done the homework, or we've done the homework, or you've done your homework, and you have a very high probability that a specific thing is going to happen, whatever your particular move is, that's the risk you're trying to reduce. You're trying to make sure that you are right, and that you've done everything to make sure that you're right. If you've done that, then the static dollar amount that you're risking becomes much less critical, because the odds of the trade being correct are so much higher. And with that, you can go in and place your stop at the appropriate place under that set of conditions. And, you know, in most cases, if you've done your homework right, you're going to be correct. You know, if you come to a casino here in Las Vegas, like, say, blackjack, which is the probably one of the more popular games, I'm sure, you sit at the table, the lady that's dealing the cards and what are they, the pit boss, whoever the guy is there, if you stop, you're allowed to say, no, I'm not going to play that hand. That's fine. But if you just sit there and wait for the deck to get loaded a certain way and then only then play, they're going to kick you off the table. They're not going to let you sit at the table and wait until the deck is perfectly primed for you who's been watching the deck and counting cards or whatever you're doing to now place your bet. They're not going to let you do that. They'll let you do it once or twice, but you got to play every hand pretty much when you're sitting at the table. Now, you can get up and walk away and watch the table and then sit back down if somebody hasn't taken your seat, but they're watching all that, and the bottom line is that that's how I like to trade. I don't play every hand. You know, I know that every hand isn't, I know I'm not good enough to play every hand, and I know that the odds may not be in my favor on every hand. But I will wait for when I can see that the deck is leaning our way, so to speak, and then I'll play. And that's one of the differences between gambling and this, is that you actually have an opportunity to wait for the odds to really be in your favor as you understand it. And you can still be wrong. That's absolutely a possibility. But the odds of your being wrong are much less, and that's the whole name of the game, is to reduce those odds and then trade effectively. And still trade by managing risk. You know, you have to have that stop in, and if you get stopped out, you know, you may, maybe you have to re-enter the trade or so on. But most of the, if any of you, if somebody said to you, listen, and I've said this so many times, but I'll just repeat it, if somebody you really cared about, I mean, deeply cared about, gave you their money, you would trade differently with that money than you trade your own. I can pretty much guarantee you, if you're anything like me. And that's where I learned all this, was by trading for other people that I cared for. And I didn't actually intend on trading for them. I wanted to just, you know, hold their money because they've been asking me so many times. And then finally, when I did trade, it would be the one time in a month where I could say, well, this is really, obviously, this is a great trade. I'm decimating my own account while I'm trading beautifully in this other person's account. You actually can trade better than you do now. It's just that we're tempted all day long to get in. You know, you're sitting in front of the machine all day long, you want to get in. And this is one of the reasons why there are so many systems out there now that is like a one trade a day thing. Part of that, I mean, there's other reasons, but part of it is because people do tend to do the wrong thing the longer they sit in front of the screen. Mm-hmm. I would say that the odds are that for most people, the longer you sit in front of that screen, the worse your judgment gets. Mm-hmm. I would say even that after the first hour, if we had a graph of your ability to judge things correctly, that the graph falls off dramatically even after the first hour. And by the fourth or fifth hour, you know, it's a whole different thing. It takes real practice to keep your judgment clear while you're looking at this stuff and you haven't made any money today and you're thinking you should make money today and all those forces are at work, you know.
Yep. Ultimately, one of the things that I teach is negative screen time. And it's probably one of the most difficult concepts that some of our students have to learn how to deal with. Hey, I want to be in front of the screen. I want to practice. I want to learn. I have a burning desire. And I try to explain to them something. It's what you've just touched on. There is a line in the sand where you go into negative screen time and you do yourself more damage than good. And so I won't spend a lot of time talking about it right now, but I agree with you 100%. And some of you out there, we're ringing a bell, and you're going, I think that might be me, okay? There's a point when you do yourself more harm than good by sitting in front of that screen. So what you need is you need some help. You need a mentor. You need somebody to talk to you and maybe guide and direct you to figure out what is right, what is appropriate, and each person is unique and different. So there was a comment from Ed. Now he says, who originally asked the gold question, for clarification, I'm not looking for long gold yet personally. I've been short the last 2 weeks via an ETF, and I'm trying to decide if we are going to break lower as I still have a small piece left.
Well, first of all, that's an amazing trade, honestly, to have been short for the last 2 weeks in gold is a outstanding place to be. And I realize that the ETFs are easier to hold. We happen to be in gold ourselves, not on the short side, but a longer, much, much longer term position. It's really more of a hedge against inflation for an account that we're trading for. So, but we use ETFs in that. But that's a really fantastic thing. I wonder what prompted the trade. But either way, I would say to you that from this point forward, you know, certainly daily closes, I'll give you two levels, below 1087 and then 1095. I think those two levels are pretty important probably to keep the short side intact at this point. So this is, again, in the futures market that we're referring to. So I would say that as an example, so if we close today below both those levels, well, then I would stay short. And I would want to not be short if we saw the market getting back above, I mean, really kind of a tight one would be 1087, but 1095 would be another one that you would want to consider.
What we're looking for here on gold is as soon as price touches this little shadowed area here, once the shadowed area is touched, we put this up. This original long side we put up on the live show September 23rd. A couple days ago, we put this little addition on as we come down. Once we've touched this little area that I've shadowed in, and by touch it, I just simply mean price touches the area. It can penetrate it, it can go below it, but once it's touched it, it's got to touch it first. Then we want to be long at 1085.1. And our targets are 1096, followed by 1107. That's what we're going to do with this if and when the opportunity presents itself. And ultimately, the opportunity will present itself unless gold, you know, really starts to tank and takes out these previous lows. We had a low July 24th of 1073.70. So we're not expecting that or anticipating that. I think we're going to catch a bounce here, and we're prepared for it. And for those who want to discuss this trade, we can talk about it during the after show today here on the program. So just stick around when we're done talking with David. Now, David, there's a question also for you on crude. Couple people. Let's see. Oh, let me before we go off of gold, let me share this. John D. asked a question. Isn't gold suffering because of the Fed's bias on interest rates? Do you have an opinion on that, Dave?
Well, Jerry Fagnant has said, and Jerry Fagnant is someone that works with us, he is of the belief that gold is responding to and positioning itself partly because of the dollar, the increase in the dollar, and because of, I mean, certainly posturing for the interest rate rise. You know, when they tighten rates, that would be negative on gold. That would be a definitive negative on gold. So I think that's probably, if you need a reason, you know, that would be a reason right there. So I'm not really good at the fundamentals, meaning that I can hear some news about fundamentals and say, well, this is what that means, and this is where the market's going to go because of that. But I can tell you this, that over the last several weeks, especially after the last couple of weeks when Janet Yellen made it pretty clear that we will see an interest rate rise in December, that we've seen a lot of new positioning of the markets. The gold has really accelerated to the downside. Dollar has accelerated upside. Euro to the downside. I don't know the direct connection between all this and crude, but crude has continued lower here. I don't have a new indication for crude just at this time, speaking of that market, but I think a lot of markets have quickly positioned themselves for a new reality, which is that we will have the Fed intervention now for the first time tightening rates in 9 years. So that has to have some meaning to the markets. I don't understand the meaning fully, but I think there's meaning there, and it's a skill. You know, that's another skill. So, okay.
So that's your take. Do you have anything else you want to add on crude? Because a couple people had said, do you have anything at all? The bond market is closed today for Veterans Day. Now, there was some early trading, so apparently they opened for the Globex session because I do show some activity. But as far as we were concerned, today would be a day that bonds did not trade. Anything else you want to add on crude, David?
Well, I'm looking at your chart right now with, is that gold or is that crude?
This is crude. Yeah.
So, yeah, we've really seen some great, great continued move here. We've had a couple of trades in crude over the last couple of weeks, but we're flat right now, and I don't have another real forecast. I mean, I hate to go with too much generality here. Mm-hmm. We're waiting and watching crude. We'll see if we can come up with something. But now, right now, we're flat in it.
Even though bonds are closed today or are closed for the afternoon,
I think the bonds actually closed at noon or 1 o'clock. They were open today for a short period of time.
Yeah, but as we can see, it was pretty flat. Do you have anything you want to share? And then also, there's that dollar trade that we had talked about, but we'll go to that in a minute. Anything at all on bonds you want to share?
Probably not. There's a couple of things that we're working on. I mean, we do have something on bonds that we're interested in, but it's, there's too much if then in it right now. So we're waiting, and I'll address that. We'll leave that.
Did you have any charts you wanted to show today?
I can show a couple charts here, and
I'll send them your
way.
Let's
go through those, and then.
There you go.
Just briefly on the right hand side here, this is yesterday's trade. This is the S&P should close. This is actually a 2-hour chart. I just showed you this because the 2 hours rather than one, it just took up less space. But we're looking for hourly closes above 2067, at or above 2067. So we could go long in this area for an advance to 2078. Here's the advance to 2078. This is the force hitting the market right there. That's what we were tracking. That is the expression of the force in the market. The market got up to a high of 2079 right there, and then 2086 to 2087 into early today. And early today on the Globex, and only the Globex, the market got up to 2087.25 and completed that. So these are two targets. Both of them, you can see the market had reactions off of the 2078 here and the 2087 there. But as I said before, this morning's decline and test of 2070 is pretty important to us. If the only people that are in this trade are people that were aggressive to get long and take some off at 2077, and they got up to that 2078, that's this same number again replaying, and that's why we use that. The larger picture is that as long as we're above the 2070 level, we'll probably remain bullish. But I want to see more of the day before we really put that into a bigger trade. Earlier in the week, we had some small trades on the downside, 4-point move down here. This was this morning. Aggressive's going to go long here at 2073, exit partials at 2077. So that's for people who might want to be holding for the longer position. This was a 10-point move on Monday. Watch for a successful test of 2064 to 2063. We got down to 2062. I consider that a successful test. And then advanced to 2074 to 75. So this is exactly the kind of stuff that we do. Yes, we had to sit through some here on these pullbacks, but the market did complete 2077.50. And it really wasn't as hard as it might have looked to stay with this. This is a 15-minute chart. And that is part of trading, is we were waiting for that force to hit. And until we saw this decline over on the right here, where we got down to complete the 2064 and 2063 level, that kind of opened the door again to more normal market movement, I think. We had been kind of choppy for several days here, and that period of time has passed now. So we're more interested now in the S&P. Okay, I'm going to switch these back to you, Dwayne. There you are.
Got it. Okay.
You had mentioned the dollar. Let's go over there. Or the euro. Were you saying the euro or the dollar?
No, let's take a look at the dollar. We're waiting on price to pull back into the support area, and then we're going to trade it on the long side as it moves out of the area. We're going to go long at 98.81. That's our plan for the dollar. How about you, Dave? What you got?
Well, we had felt that 99.55 was going to be very difficult, at least temporarily, for the market to get through. We put out a report stating that if the market, you know, touched and failed at 99.55, that we could go short at that level. And we've used a very, very tight stop. We are still short, but we used a stop at 99.65. So sometimes, you know, people will say, well, gosh, your stops are bigger than others. You know, there are times when our stops are very small. You know, using a 10-tick stop for this move so far, we've gotten down to 98.88. And, you know, so it hasn't been too bad. But the market's pretty quiet here, and I do have some concern as I'm looking at this market. I'm still somewhat concerned that the market's in a pretty strong position and may, you know, ultimately get higher than 99.55. So that is something that I'm just going to keep an eye on here. But our plan is to wait for a little bit more evidence, and we've moved our protective stop down now to protect a little more of this trade. And at this point, it would have to be considered to be a pretty much a free trade. But we don't rush to a break even. That's not something that we're interested in doing. We're more interested in being in the trade than trying to break even in the trade. And that goes back to that whole thing about if you've really done your homework and you're not just taking shots, you know, you have a real reason to be in the market, and you don't want to be out of the market. You want to be in the market. So our approach is to often, anyway, use a stop that really keeps the market away from an area that it really shouldn't go to unless we're really wrong. And we don't believe we're going to be really wrong, otherwise we wouldn't be in the market. So we've done our homework, and that's the real risk that we talk about. You know, it's a little bit of, for us, a little bit amateur hour to always be thinking your risk is just your money. Because a person can come to you and say, you know, here's 22-point risk trades, and the gain would be, you know, 10 points. So you're going to risk 2 and you're going to make 10. Now here's 20 of them. You can be wrong 20 times in a row for 2 points. So obviously, whatever your stop is, how many points it is, has no connection to whether or not the trade is really going to be right or not. And people tend to think, and this again goes back to because people don't think about what they think about, people tend to think that having a closer stop means it's a better trade. It has nothing to do with it. Your closer stop or farther stop, either one, it doesn't have anything to do with the quality of the trade. It's just a place where you're putting your stop. What does have to do with the quality of the trade is your ability to read the market, understand what the conditions are that surround it right now, and make a very high probability or a somewhat high probability understanding of what the market's likely going to do. And with that, then you want to place your stop in a place that the market is unlikely to go to under that set of conditions. So there you are. So consider that, because a lot of people think, oh, I'm only risking 2 points or 1 point or 5 points. So that doesn't refer to the quality of the trade at all. Go ahead.
Timothy asked, did the move to 2087 expend the energy of the ES daily bottom?
Well, it did enough for us to take a long position, but the really important thing is for us now is that, because this was an aggressive trade. We don't put out a lot of aggressive versus normal, but we occasionally, it's good enough to say, listen, if you're aggressive, you can just get in here because we think there's enough here to say that you can. So if we really felt absolutely sure, we would all be in our normal positions on the long side. So we don't have that kind of certainty yet. The certainty level is not high enough for us yet, but it came close. And so the answer is kind of, you know, pretty much yes, that's what we think. But there's some extra time in this trade that we think is the market is really not quite ready to show its hand yet. And so we're waiting a little longer here to collect more evidence to get the rest of us in. And as I've said so many times, if we have to get in and make less money but do so with more certainty, I think that's one of the best deals throughout the universe. You know, if I had a spaceship that said less money with more certainty or less gain with more certainty, you know, I could fly across the universe, and if that could be translated, I think other people would understand it. It's worth thinking about that. You know, it's not all, the better trade isn't always the bigger trade. The better trade is the more certain trade. You know, consistency is what we're after. Most traders are spending most of their time making up losses. That's what most traders are doing. So we don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. We want to try to be in the camp, if you will, of people who are trading when the odds are most likely to be correct. And therefore, yes, occasionally you're going to get something incorrect. You're going to have some percentage. Something's going to be wrong somewhere. But you don't want to be constantly just making up a set of previous losses trying to get ahead. That shows that you're not really trading with authentic high probability yet. Anyone can, but you might not be there yet. So go ahead, Dwayne.
Let's see. Missed your short-term forecast on the S&P. Can you repeat it in a sentence or two?
Yeah, just that we just think, generally speaking, that the market is probably going to be going higher. We think there is, you know, for lack of a better term, the cycle is kind of up over the next couple of days here, and we want to take advantage of that. And we've given out the targets and so on, and we're just waiting to see more evidence here.
Stu wanted to know, let's see, Stu said, I would like your update on the 1 year late of the ES yearly top. Thanks.
Yeah, there's no real new information to give. We would like to see it printed. We cannot rule out the possibility of an all-time new yearly high before the year is printed. We're not forecasting that we're going to have that. But I do think that once that top is in, we're going to see a multi-year decline. That's what normally happens, and what I forecast is what is normal. Under some conditions, I can forecast, you know, something that's unusual, but we generally stick to what we think is the normal thing to happen under a given set of conditions again, and that's what we would look for, the yearly top getting put in. So I hope that's useful.
Gotcha. Okay.
And Dwayne, it's about 10:45, and would like to stay, but I.
No, that's fine. Tomorrow we'll talk about the debate. We're going to hit the markets first, and if there's time left over, we'll talk about the debate. All right.
Okay. Very good. Well, thanks for having me on. Thanks for the questions, and I'll see you all here tomorrow.
Have a good afternoon.
Thank you, Dwayne.
Bye bye.
See you. Bye bye.
Steven, I see your question. For the after show, what type of trades are the gold and dollar trades? Both are using support as an area to get long. And so I typed in a question, type question mark, because I wasn't sure what you meant by what type of trade, partner trade or just using support. Those are trades based on reading the chart, Stephen. You hear me make the comment a lot that what people really need more than they need a crystal ball or a guru or a magic number or an indicator or an oscillator is that we're best served by learning to read the charts. If we can learn to read what the chart is telling us, then we can place trades like this dollar trade. I mean, we've got a nice leg and a retracement and a leg and a retracement. Now, as we come back into this area, you are absolutely correct. I'm looking for support to kick in. And for me, it's not important where support holds, okay? I'm not trying to pinpoint a certain dollar amount, but once support has shown itself and price has validated support because we trade above 98.80, that's when I'm interested in being long the trade up to 99.30. So that's all it is. There's no indicator involved. It's not a partner trade like a 137 or a slingshot trade or momentum trade. It's just looking at the chart and understanding how markets move, how people think, not necessarily individually how people think, but how people think as a group. It's usually with a negative connotation that people use the term herd mentality, but I don't mean it in a negative way, but groups of people do. In fact, I asked Jim Cox, who's going to be coming on live here in just a couple minutes, Jim Whitebar Cox, developer of the White Bar Trade, he'll be joining me. I asked him last week or the week before about that very thing. Was it easier to judge how an individual is going to react to a certain situation or a group of people? And I was glad to hear him say that he thought the group was easier to judge because any individual can be a lone wolf. I talked about this a little bit yesterday. In fact, I heard a statistic the other day that I was a bit shocked. 1 in 25 people is a sociopath. Okay? Now, what's a sociopath? We're going to go to Jim in just a second. Sociopath. Define sociopath. A person with a personality disorder manifesting itself in extreme antisocial attitudes and behavior and a lack of conscience. Now, 1 in 25, I mean, if you're at the grocery store, And you look down across all the checkout lines, if it's a, you know, busy day or, you know, afternoon, Friday payday, Saturday, you know, you'll see 25 people in a very small enclosed area. There'll be at least 25 people. Now, this includes the clerks and the checkout boys. And I mean, there might be 50. Just think about it. If there's 50, I mean, what would that take? 5 lines of 10 people each? It's not a lot, but you've got 2 people. If there's 50, there's 2, if this study is correct, who have a lack of conscience. In other words, they could bump into you, hit you, kick you, stab you, lie to you, rob you, and have no feeling of guilt or remorse. We've all seen Law and Order episodes where the suspect, quote unquote, showed no remorse for their crime. Now, when I heard that number, 1 in 25, I couldn't help but say, gosh, I hope they're wrong. So you never know if you've got that 1 in 25. So that's why I believe that it's easier to predict group behavior than individual behavior. Because I've got 24 that are probably going to behave based on conventional social norms. But there's that one guy. Now, if I got 24 people behaving in a certain way, they're going to override the activity of the one. Or, like on that train in France, they're going to kick his butt. Pardon the French. Right? That guy's on Dancing with the Stars, one of them, one of the 3 who took down the terrorist on the train in France. He's another fun fact, no one tell. Okay, let me go find Jim and bring him into the mix. Jim Whitebar Cox, there he is. Hey, Jim, welcome to the show.
Hello, Dwayne. How are you today?
Good, buddy. Have you ever known a sociopath?
Not personally, I haven't. I did a child abuse case years ago, and the guy that was involved in it, I believe he was a sociopath. He just had no real understanding of right and wrong. So.
Yeah, and no remorse for what he did.
Correct.
You know, you hurt your wife or you hurt your child. Now, the way this study that I read described it is it's almost as if they lack a gene. I don't know if they use the term gene or not, but they lack something in their physiological makeup that it's just they don't feel it. it's is that the definition of pure evil, a missing gene? I don't think so, because I've stared pure evil in the face, and it stared back, and it also left a big black eye on my face. You've probably dealt with evil people, bad people. I mean, you spent years as a law enforcement officer. Do you think, how common is it to come across somebody who is just, well, there's mean-spirited, then there's mean drunks, I guess, and then there's people that are just, like, evil. Did you find that very often?
No, not really. I mean, you had people who just, you know, they committed crimes for various reasons, but you know, there were a few, especially like when you get into the gangs and the gangbangers, mm-hmm. you find some pretty evil people involved in those that just have had a rough life, and they're going to take it out on you at any turn that they can.
Well, so I mean, that whole initiation thing that they do where you've got to shoot somebody or something, you know, I don't know if that's still a thing, but we've all seen
it. They have
it.
All kinds of different initiations into yeah. to the various gangs. So
I mean, that in and of itself, that whole mentality, that whole way of thinking, to me, that's pure evil. That's not putting evil on any one individual except those who subscribe to that, who are a part of that, who,
right.
you know, look at a now, it's not just in the street gangs of L.A., or New York, or any big city, USA, this same type of mentality exists in Africa, in the Congo, in the jungles. They'll come in, and these rebels will rape and pillage an entire village, burn it to the ground, and then they'll take the young boys, 13, 14 years old, slap a machine gun in their hand, and say, you're either one of us, or we're gonna punch your clock. You're gonna punch. You know what I'm saying. And
you're either with us or against us. There's
yeah,
no gray
that's it.
Area.
Right. And so that is evil to me, pure evil. And so I realize we're getting far away from the markets talking about pure evil, but I just
okay.
wanted to clarify with folks what I mean about the ability to foresee how a group of people will act when we come back into this support area. How people will act, I think, if it was just one guy, one trader, I wouldn't have a clue. But the group, I'm pretty sure I know how they'll behave. Now, will they be able to get all the way to the target? I don't know. Will they be able to take out the target and maybe add another leg? I don't know. What I do know is that I believe they will at least try. And that's what the entire trade is based upon, the assumption that they will at least try. Even if they don't succeed, the fact that they make an attempt should move the market far enough for us to have a profitable trade. Same thing over here with gold. Now, we got... How far down did we get? Looks like we may have touched that thing today. Let me just open this up. Nope, not quite. The swing low today in gold was 1083.20. And the top of this line is 1082. So we still need to drop about another dollar. And it's possible that we don't. We could turn and go north from here. What I'm looking for is for this area to hold as support long enough to give us a bounce. That's it. Not looking for anything beyond a bounce. I mean, because I'm long-term bullish on gold, I think we'll recover and recover nicely. And I think we'll have new historic prices at some point down the road. I don't know when that will be. But I just think history has shown us that over the longer time frame, gold is a storehouse of value, and people have all, you know, from the ancient kings up until today, People want gold. I mean, I've always, I go, it's just a shiny metal, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, I got rocks in my driveway that in some other culture, in some other time, you know, the gravel that I walk on in my drive could be considered some precious thing. It's like that, what was that one movie where the Coke bottle fell out of the airplane and it fell in the jungle in this native tribe that had no contact with modern civilization? I think it was a Mel Brooks movie. And so they began to worship this Coke bottle. That became their god because it fell out of the sky. Now,
I am not familiar with that movie.
The gods must be crazy. Charles says that was a great movie. I don't think I've actually seen the movie, Charles. I'm going to check Netflix and see if it's on Netflix. I haven't actually seen it, but I understand the principle and the concept. Here's a people, have no contact with modern civilization. All of a sudden, this thing drops out of the sky and being a simple people, right, who probably don't read or write, they grunt at each other. I gotta see the movie, but Charles gives it at least a one thumb up. So, Jim, I alluded to something at the beginning of the show. I said that you and a group of six, you guys had a meeting in, where was your meeting at this past weekend?
Kansas City.
In Kansas City. And so what Jim's been doing, he's been working with some of the partners. Now, the requirement, and I don't know if Jim's taking anybody else or not, that's entirely up to him, but this is a company-sanctioned event, and he's been working with six people. I believe it's six, is that right?
Yes.
You have to be an active partner. You have to have at least 6 months' experience as a partner, because Jim's just trying to help those who need a little help. He's not doing it to teach you this is a candlestick, this is a trend line. He's just, you know, out of the goodness of his heart, willing to work with some of the folks who need a little help. So why don't you tell us, Jim, in your own words, what the meeting was like and what the experience so far this week has been, and share as much as you want, and it, whenever you want me to send the charts over to you, let me know and I'll do that.
I've got a mess on my charts, but let's talk and then we'll see where we need to go from there.
Okay. And we don't have to go to your charts if you don't want to. So.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see okay. how it plays out. I had a call from a gentleman. I originally went to one of Michael's seminars, and that was in Kansas City in May of last year, 2014. And at that meeting, I met several other CFN partners, and I've been with the help of CFRN and the website, or I'm sorry, the email that they've given me, jim@cfrn.net, several of them have reached out. As I've been talking about the white bar trading and sharing some of the success and pitfalls that I've seen, a lot of them are experiencing the same thing. So one of the gentlemen called and asked if there was any possibility I could meet in Kansas City on Saturday the 7th, and I said, well, yes, I can. As a matter of fact, my son is having a surprise birthday party, so let's set a meeting for 1:30. So he said some of the other guys from Kansas City meeting back in 2014 might like to attend as well, so we extended an invitation out to that group of gentlemen, and we had six people show up at the meeting, and when I got there, somehow I got to be the facilitator of it. I thought it was just going to be a brainstorming type thing, but I facilitated the meeting, and the meeting went really well. But there was a common thread that I was seeing with several of the partners that they just weren't having success on a consistent basis. We talked about it. We came to an understanding that there were some things that all of us as traders have to have. You have to have your business trading plan. You have to follow the rules. You have to be very disciplined. So after 3 hours of going through all these things, they asked if there was any possibility that I could help them or have another trading room set up to where we could work together to try and get them to a consistent 10 tick day on a regular basis. So I approached Michael and Dwayne and explained what was going on, and they were gracious enough to give us a trading room. So that started on Monday. Well, what is today? Today's Wednesday. It started on Tuesday, I guess. Yesterday was the...
Yesterday was the maiden voyage. That's right.
Yesterday was the maiden voyage. And so we were all in there, and it's very informal. I don't, by any means, try to say I'm a guru or I'm you know, one of these guys is going to call trades and they're going to follow.
We're having him fitted for a long robe at the moment. So.
Yeah, that's what it is. So it's more of a Q&A. We all have microphones. We all have headsets, so we talk to each other. I'm not doing the whole chat box thing. Running a trading room is new to me. And there's a lot that goes on with that, and as questions are coming in, it's easier just to verbalize. And the guys will say, hey, Jim, this is so-and-so, and my question is, why'd you do this or why'd you do that? And then I answer that. They have all been very appreciative of me helping them with that. And the focus of the room is primarily we're watching for white bar trades, and we're taking those trades. In addition, I'm pointing out other trades as they set up, the 137s, the 128s, the 164s, the slingshot trades. Anything that presents itself that I've been trained in and I'm able to see, I point out to those guys. And it's incumbent upon them whether or not they want to take those trades or they want to learn those trades. But what I have told them is that they basically need to find something that works, something that gives them a warm, fuzzy feeling, and stick with it. Rather than trying to do 100 different things or bring baggage from another trading program or another methodology, you know, we strictly focus on CFRN trades. One of those trades is the white bar. Since I'm pretty proficient with the white bar, that is the main focus of the room. So yesterday, and this is a pre-market, we're generally between 7:30 and 8:30 Central Time, an hour before the market opens. We went longer today because the market, I guess with it being Veterans Day, the banks being closed, the market didn't give a whole lot of opportunities. So we went a little longer. We had a couple of stopouts to start the day off, and we built back from that. So everybody in the room yesterday got their 10 ticks. We got those pretty quickly yesterday. Oh, let me get my notes. We got those yesterday in, hold the phone.
I think you told me five trades, I believe.
Five trades, 37 minutes yesterday. Now, today was Today was a little harder on us. Like I say, we had two 10-tick stopouts. And as many of you know, I've gone to a 6-tick range chart as opposed to the 4-tick range. So with that, I've gone to a 10-tick stop. We had two stopouts early in the day, so we were kind of behind the 8-ball, down 20 ticks. So we went a little longer. Some of the guys got their 10 ticks. A couple of the guys are still in sim. They're not comfortable enough yet to go to a live market. I was able to get my 10 ticks, but it did take me quite a while today. I didn't stop trading. My last trade was at, let me get my notes here. 10:33 was my last trade, and I had 21 trades today to get to my 10 tick goal. So a little bit longer, you know what, it is what it is. And running a trading room, for me, and Dwayne tried to explain this to me, it does take a lot of your concentration and your focus away.
Oh, my goodness, yeah.
Yep. So I'm learning as we go, and we're able to help help these six guys. They can't be appreciative enough. They have thanked me over and over. They look forward to getting up and trading in the morning again. So we've got the right attitude going. We just need to get everybody consistent and moving forward on the 24/20 program.
So. Amen. That's awesome. And so, guys, if you are active and you've got 6 months' experience as a partner, send Jim an email, jim@cfrn.net, and then he'll dialogue with you a bit via email and see if this is something that's going to work and be a fit for you. Bob Z just said, oh, hook me up, please. And so when you get an email from Bob Z, he is active and he has been with us forever. And he's factory approved.
he's got the stamp of approval.
He does. So if you don't want to go through charts today, we haven't talked about any news at all, and there was actually a request in the chat box. Do you have any comments? I think they were trying to get David to go on one of his soapbox rants about the politics. Did you watch the debate last night?
Yes, I did.
Anything you took away that you want to share?
You know, I thought that Donald Trump was a little more subdued than normal. I'm hearing a lot of the same things, though. He's going to build a wall. It's going to be a great wall. It's going to have a beautiful door, and the immigrants can come in legally. You know, we have all these presidential candidates talking about immigration, and that was originally addressed with Donald Trump, and that's how it became a big issue. As far as immigration, you know, he talks about sending 11 or 12 million people out of the country. Logistically, I don't know how that's going to happen. He's never really laid out a plan how that's going to happen, who's going to pay for it, or how it's all going to work. I think they're trying to overthink this thing. You know, a lot of these people that are here are trying to lead productive lives, trying to take care of their families just like the rest of us. Mm-hmm. So rather than scoop them up, break up families, and send them back to wherever they came from, why don't we institute a program where you as an illegal immigrant have 6 months to register when the whenever they pass a law or pass a bill. Within that six-month period, you register as a legal immigrant, and then from that point you've got time to get into the classes, to learn the language, to start paying taxes, to identify as a potential American citizen. So within that six-month period, if you've got, you know, a few hundred thousand that didn't want to register for whatever reason, they've committed crimes, they have felony convictions, they just don't want to deal with the government, well, it's a whole lot easier to send back a few hundred thousand as opposed to 12 million. So I think rather than try to ship them away, scare these people to death, scare these families, and think that, you know, oh my gosh, if Donald Trump is elected, you know, we may get shipped back to another country, I think there has to be some common sense put onto this rather than thinking we're going to send all these people away. So that's my two cents worth on the whole immigration thing. Moving on with the debate, I thought John Kasich was rude. I thought that him cutting in and trying to over-talk everybody else was some strategy that either he or his campaign people said might benefit him.
He's dead in the water at this point. And, you know, he made a comment about they were talking about Bank of America and whether it should go bankrupt or not.
Yeah, he got booed during that.
Here's what he said. He said, I don't believe in a bank that's too big to fail. However, people who do business with Bank of America, if they're hardworking people, then I'm gonna save them. But the ones who have more than enough,
the ones who can afford it,
are gonna take the hit.
Right.
Who in the heck made him God? Not
judge and jury. Exactly.
I couldn't believe the soundbite and. But he really said it, and I think he's done. He's not even in the race anymore. So
I haven't watched any news today. I've been busy all morning. So I'm curious to see what the prognosticators have to say about his comments. But yeah, I agree. I think that he put a fork in himself there. He's done. So it's time to get out of the race and move on to the next one. But I'm of the opinion there's never an excuse or never a time where rudeness is acceptable. And I thought he was rude last night and boisterous and overbearing. And I know that they want to get their points across, but at some point you've got to step back and let somebody finish their thought and finish their comment before you cut them off. So yeah. I'm not a John Kasich fan. Yeah. My top three right now are Trump, Rubio, and Cruz, followed closely by Carly Fiorina. I was pretty high on Ben Carson for a while. Right. I just don't think he's got a strong enough personality to take this country where it needs to go. We need recovery. And I think we need a strong, very strong leader to do that. And I think we need to build our military and become the strength that we used to be. And when a Putin goes into a country where we have allies, we can puff our chest out and say, hey, get out of there or you're going to deal with us. Just like Teddy Roosevelt said, you walk tall and carry a big stick.
Mm-hmm. Now, this mudslinging that began on Friday with Ben Carson about what he said or didn't say, what was in his book or not in his book. Do you think he did anything wrong? Do you think he intentionally misled people in any way? Or are they just, as he said, come on, you guys, really, you didn't vet Obama. You just let this guy waltz into the White House.
Right.
And you're questioning me about, now, does it matter or does it not matter? I mean, what do you think?
You know, I don't think he did anything wrong. I think that he is fairly trustworthy. I think he's a pretty honest guy. And I wish in his book he would have written, I was offered a verbal scholarship, or Colonel Westmoreland said to me, hey, I'd be willing to give you a free ride to West Point. Rather than use the word scholarship and leave it at that,
yeah.
I think it was ambiguous. And maybe he was trying to just show, you know, he was offered this. Somebody saw some greatness in him. Mm-hmm. But I think the terminology was probably misleading. But now that he's explained it, I think that media needs to back off, especially the mainstream media. I mean, they think they've got a whale on a hook right now, and they're just going to fight this thing until they drag it on board. But, you know, I guess it's with Ben Carson, so he made a faux pas. He said something that it can't truly be verified. I guess unless you get a hold of Colonel Westmoreland, and I believe he's passed away.
Well, one of the things that I read, and again, you don't know what's true. I mean, it used to be if it was on TV, you knew it was the truth. And then if it was on the internet, it really had to be the truth. And now now you just don't know. But
hey, if you believe that, I've got some property, some oceanfront property here in Missouri I want to sell you.
All right. I'll take a look at it.
All right. Sounds good.
Now, they say that according to official documents, because people like General Westmoreland, they have official itineraries and pretty much you always know where they are. According to one article I read, on that day and time when supposedly he was at this dinner in Detroit where this conversation would have taken place, that according to the official records, he was in New York on that day playing tennis. And as I explained that to my wife, she said something very astute, as she often does. She said, well, did you know that you can fly from Detroit to New York in about an hour? And I said, huh, I didn't even think about that.
Sure.
So, in other words, could he have played tennis with somebody in New York and been at the dinner in Detroit all in the same day? Yeah, he could have.
Sure, sure. Well, and part of the problem that I have with Ben Carson, he talks about his when he was a child in junior high school and high school, he had a violent streak.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess that was brought on by his upbringing, by his father leaving and having a second family. I mean, I understand 100% why that would manifest itself. And I think it's wrong that the mainstream media has gone back and tried to locate kids who can verify this this mean streak or this violent streak.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we all have skeletons in our closet.
Boy.
And things that you do as a child, as a juvenile, should be left in that arena. And there's an interview that he had done, and I forget which show it was on. He talked about coming after his mother with a hammer. And, you know, whether that happened or not, I don't know how it has any bearing on his ability to be president of the United States. It didn't have any bearing on him being able to be a neurosurgeon. And
well, you know what? When he wrote that book, let's go back to motive. When he wrote that book, how long ago he wrote his autobiography?
1999, the book was released.
Okay, so in 99, do you think he had a master plan that says 16 years from now, I'm going to run for president of the United States of America?
Absolutely not. I don't think that was ever an aspiration.
What would his motivation be to paint himself in such an ugly light? I mean, if it weren't true, I mean, if I had gone after my mother with a hammer, I would probably have a hard time admitting it. I mean, it would be like a cathartic thing. It would be me coming clean with myself. I just can't imagine making up a story like that.
No, and I can't either. And I think personally why he did that is because he came from a socioeconomically depressed area.
Mm-hmm.
His mother didn't have a lot of money. His father had left him. So I think he's trying to reach out to the rest of the black community, the socioeconomically depressed community, and say, hey, I went through a lot of the same things that you did. I was angry about my situation. I was angry about the way things happened. I was mad because I didn't have a dad in the family. But I overcame that. I became a neurosurgeon. So I think he's trying to share those stories maybe as an encouragement,
as
a mentor to these other kids, mm-hmm. to try and say, mm-hmm. hey, anything's possible. You know, don't get on that perpetual train. Don't get on the...
I see a guy that bares his soul and says, you know what, I was a pretty messed up kid. And now along come people and try to say, no, you weren't. No, you weren't messed up. You weren't angry.
Yeah.
You know, well... it's ridiculous is what it is. I mean, as he said, you know, we have a world, we have world situations going on right now. We have real world problems that we need to be addressing and talking about and finding solutions for. And, and you're going to hang me out to dry over what I said to somebody in the 10th grade?
Exactly.
Ridiculous. I mean, even Obama has admitted at this point, in his book, Dreams of My Father, he talks about a girl that he dated as a young man. He has since come clean. He had to, because no one could find that girl. And so he said, well, she didn't really exist. She was a composite of a number of different young women that I knew and dated.
Mad scientist. He put them all together into one.
He did. Frankenbride. Yeah.
Exactly. Okay. There you go. There you go. So my opinion of Ben Carson is I think he's a pretty honest and trustworthy guy. I think he's a very smart guy. So I think the Republicans need to get together and they need to put a team together. You know, let's go Trump for president, Rubio for vice president, Fiorina for secretary of state, put Ben Carson in charge of the Department of Health, and let him come up with a
That's a pretty good lineup. Plan. You know, I like the way you put that together. Now, they say that last night, Senator Cruz had a Rick Perry moment. In a moment, some people compared to one of the most memorable debate gaffes in recent history. Cruz named the same department twice when listing the federal agencies he would eliminate. Now, this just goes to show what an incredible spotlight people are under, you know, not only being president, but just, you know, running for, just trying to become the nominee. They're going to pick apart every word. I mean, how many times during this radio program today have I misspoke or said something that wasn't grammatically correct or just had a brain cramp and couldn't remember? I mean, good Lord. Now, here's what he said. Five major agencies that I would eliminate. The IRS.
Good.
The Department of Commerce.
Good.
Department of Energy. The Department of Commerce. And HUD. Now, they're calling that a Rick Perry moment. During a 2012 primary debate, then Texas Governor Rick Perry tried to list the three agencies he would eliminate, but struggled to name the third. He gave up after a bit, infamously adding oops to punctuate the moment. But Cruz was in good humor when Fox host Megyn Kelly, who I used to really like, when she was on the show before she took leave of absence, had her baby, and came back and got her own show. I used to really like her. She came back. Motherhood made her mean or something. I don't know.
Yeah, but now she's got that that butch haircut going on, so she's not even looking as good as she used to. So I guess she's got a mean streak in her now. She's mad about her haircut.
Okay. But, yeah, well, you know, a bad burrito you can get over in a day, but a bad haircut, it takes a long time. But Cruz was in good humor when Fox host Megyn Kelly asked the senator about the incident and the end of their interview after the debate. I just think the Department of Commerce is such a base of cronyism. We need to eliminate it twice, he said. So that was a pretty good comeback.
Did he list the other agency that he wanted to get rid of? I hope it's the Department of Labor.
He added that he meant to say the Department of Education.
That's a good one to get rid of as well. So let's put Department of Labor, Department of Education. Did he say Department of Energy? Because those guys need to go bye-bye too.
Yep. He said, again, they were the IRS. And I think every candidate on the Republican stage wants to eliminate the IRS. How could anybody in their right mind not want to eliminate the IRS as we know it? Now, we're not saying don't pay taxes. Of course, in order to run a country, you must have taxes. But do you need a 70,000-page tax code?
Who could understand that?
Nobody.
There's nobody could understand that.
And one of the candidates the other day said he could reduce it to 3 pages. And
I've heard Carly Fiorina.
Yeah, and some have said, you know, you could reduce it to like one sentence. We're going to pay. I think Ben Carson, somebody last night said, how about this? If you make, now this is based, this is still an income tax. So some are for an income tax and some are for a spending tax. Not both, but one or the other. And I think it might have been Ben who said, if you make $10 billion a year, then you pay $1 billion in taxes, 10%. Right. Same thing you give to God, 10%. If you make $10, you give $1 in taxes. And so that's, I mean, can you imagine all the people that would unfortunately be out of work? I suppose not only IRS employees, but all the attorneys and government agency regulators and all of the, you know, I think.
Well, if you eliminate those five agencies, with the IRS being the first, you save all that salary, all that money. So put that back into Social Security, and let's get back on track with what the government promised us decades ago.
Well, very, very well said. Now, this Department of Education, it has not come to my son's school yet in the manner that I hear it is coming and already is in some schools. And I don't know why it isn't, because he does go to public school. But this Common Core business in Seattle, they are teaching kids stuff about you know, same-sex marriage and how how relations between a man and a man and a woman and a woman. I mean, they're actually explaining the mechanics of, you know, what they do behind closed doors. Now, my children have been instructed to stand up and walk out of class.
Yep, exactly.
Stand up,
I was
going to say,
I would pull my kids out of that classroom.
They stand up and say, I'm sorry, but my dad said that when this came up, that I'm to go stand in the hallway until you're finished. And then do it. And let the principal call me, and I'll be, I live 5 minutes from the school. I'll be right there. So.
Well, unfortunately, in today's society, not everyone can afford to send their children to private school. So if you have a Christian faith and you don't have the finances to send them to a Christian-based, Bible-based school, you have to put them in public school, and the public school system making its own determination that they're going to teach about same-sex marriages and they're going to take God out of the mix is wrong. It's just wrong as wrong can be. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, this country was founded on in God. In God we trust.
That's right.
But somewhere along the line, the forefathers who designed the Constitution based on God have gotten put to the wayside. Now, everybody talks about enforcing the Constitution, but when you've got football coaches being relieved of their duties because they pray with their team before and after a game, or you can't even sing the national anthem anymore.
Who did that happen to? Did that actually happened?
Yeah, that actually happened. There was a football coach, and I forget where the jurisdiction was at, but after every game, he would go out to this 50-yard line, and he didn't invite the guys. They just came, and his team came, and then opposing teams, the opponents that were in the match, they would come and pray. So the school went, after 8 years, the school went to him and said, you can't do that anymore. He says, well, I'm going to continue to do it. I'm praying because I believe in God, because I want to thank him for the opportunity, for the camaraderie, for keeping the kids safe. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to acknowledge the one who did all this. They said, well, if you continue to do that, then you're going to be terminated. He continued to do it. They fired him. He's got an attorney now.
Wow.
So he's going to try and get his job back. But unfortunately, this separation of state and religion, and it's just unbelievable where this thing is going. You can't even put in Christ in Christmas anymore. So, I don't know. I guess I'm on my soapbox today, and I apologize for being
good.
So
No, that's good. That's good radio. Coach fired for praying right here. Let's see if this is the same guy. There may be more than one episode of this. This might be a video.
The average American visits about seven different websites before booking a hotel. I totally get that. We want to make sure that we get a great hotel.
You guys
the best
can't
price.
Hear it, but
I why only seven when there are so many more out?
There we go. I've got the. Let's see. Okay, there's no text there, so that's just video. So let's go to high school football coach on leave for praying. Let's go to that one.
That's the one.
Yeah, October 30th. So this is recent.
That's him. That's him. Yeah, that's the guy right there.
A Washington State high school football coach placed on paid administrative leave for saying post-game prayers with his players. Attended his former team's game Thursday night and prayed with spectators. Good for him. They can't stop him from doing that.
Absolutely.
Bremerton High School assistant coach Joe Kennedy spoke to the media at halftime of the game and called watching from the bleachers one of the hardest things I've done. I'm not used to being on this side, Kennedy said. I'm used to being beside the players, listening to them. Kennedy added that it hurt his heart that the controversy had reached the point where his guys are in the locker room and I've got to be out here. Bremerton school district officials put him on leave late Wednesday because they did not want to be seen as endorsing religion. They claimed they had warned Kennedy several times that he could not pray with players on the field after games. While the district,
now it's going to change.
Yeah, while the district appreciates Kennedy's many positive contributions to the Bremerton football program, Kennedy's conduct poses a genuine risk that the district will be liable for violating the federal and state constitutional rights of students or others. Okay, so I guess we're violating the rights of people who don't believe in God, but what about the rights of people who do believe in God?
Hear, hear. I agree.
Former players describe the prayers as part of their post-game routine. It was never like we were forced to pray with him. This is from a former player. He never said, let's go pray or anything like that. We all just took it upon ourselves. Kennedy has prayed before and after games since 2008, but was only asked to stop recently after the practice came to the district's attention. Bremerton's game against Sequim was also attended by members of the Satanic Temple of Seattle, clad in black robes. The group, which had cheered the decision to put Kennedy on leave, said they went to support teachers and students who invited them. The group had also asked to perform an on-field invocation. What? Bremerton's high school.
So the atheists, the agnostics, have more say in what happens in a school than the Christians. How wrong is that?
This is bizarre.
I know.
I'm willing to take this as far as it goes to defend the rights of the Constitution to the end. Kennedy said, if you believe in something, you stand up. Yeah, I mean, how does that saying go? All it takes for evil to prevail is for good men to do nothing.
Right.
So, well, I salute this guy, and boy, he's got 100% of my support. I hadn't even heard about this. So,
yeah.
Well, they took prayers. You know, back when they had prayer in schools, how many school shootings were there?
None.
I mean, is that a coincidence? I don't think so. I mean, it's not like there were fewer. Or not as many, there were none. Oh, well, that's a ridiculous argument. Is it? Is it ridiculous? I mean, as a kid growing up, every morning we prayed our Father who art in heaven, and we said the Pledge of Allegiance. That's how we started our school day all the way up through high school. It's what we did. And, you know... We had bullies in my high school, and I got beat up pretty bad one time because we had an assembly in high school, and the assembly we had a group come in. They were a Christian group, and they were like a choir, and they sang some songs, and there was a positive motivational speech made. And then we went back to class, and Stan Jenkins, I remember you, Stan. Stan Jenkins made some rude comment about the choir, the speaker, and God. And I stood up for all three. And he's only like twice as big as me. I said, hey, you know, dude, that's wrong, you know. And I said whatever I said. I don't really remember. Kind of like Ben Carson. I don't actually remember what I said in the 10th grade. But sure. I do remember that a fight was called for 3 o'clock in the...
Under the goalposts.
Well, actually, it was across the street in the church parking lot.
Gotcha. Good spot to fight.
I got one of the worst butt kickings of my life, man. That guy just tore a hole in me. And I was taking karate classes, but, you know, doing kata and forms is one thing. when you kick and actually connect with somebody, that's a whole different feeling. So I did a spinning back kick, caught him on the chin, knocked him back, and I thought, wow, you might actually win this. And then he just slammed me, lights out.
Then it was, okay, my turn.
Oh, goodness. I remember my girlfriend helping me, you know, limp off of the playground once she woke me up.
I think the separation of church and state has gotten out of control. I belong to a local Rotary Club here in the St. Louis area a few years back. And at the beginning of the meeting, we would say the Pledge of Allegiance, and then we would sing God Bless America.
Mm-hmm.
Well, at one meeting, someone complained about that. I believe the person was agnostic and thought it was wrong that we would sing this particular song. So the president decided we wouldn't sing the song anymore. So I went to the president in open forum and I said, you know what? My membership is based on Christ. Everything in my life is Christ-centered. So if we're not going to be singing, I will no longer be a member. And I got into a vehement argument with this individual, and that was the last time I attended that particular Rotary Club. So unfortunately, it seems like the people that are opposed to thing, the against, the are so much more vocal and so much more, I guess they have so much more strength on their part as far as arguing. They just want things changed. And, you know, what's happening. Look what just happened at Mizzou with the dean being terminated.
Yeah, what is the story on that? I mean, I know that there was some kind of racial thing going on, but what really happened?
You know, I don't know what the whole thing is, but apparently the students didn't believe he was doing enough to promote better race relations. So they started a protest, and got the media involved in it. Next thing you know, the dean has to resign. So I don't know. You know, it's unfortunate. I guess we've got a lot of problems in this country, and until we have a stronger leader in the Oval Office of the White House, I don't think anything's going to change.
We need someone who doesn't stand up and make a statement like we're not a Christian nation. Now, some say that was a soundbite taken out of context. And, you know, he did go on to say we're a nation that's open to all people. But I'm sorry, we were a nation founded on Christian beliefs. We were.
Well, and Obama, didn't he, how did this play out? He stopped the National Day of Prayer and invited Muslims to the White House to have a National Day for Muslims. I don't know what the whole situation
was. He didn't recognize the National Day of Prayer, and he had a dinner party for some Muslim special interest group that same night. Yes.
Gotcha.
He made a loud statement without saying a word. He sure did. Mm-hmm. Howard, I see your question. Where should I look to find the One Trade a Day recommendations? You go to eminifuturestrading.com. Michael will send you the username and password for the markets that you've signed up for. It looks just like this, and it works perfectly on your mobile phone. In other words, it's what they call mobile responsive. So if you open this site, it's not meant to look pretty, it's meant to be functional. If you click on the Russell, it will prompt you for your username and your password, and then you log in, and there you have the trade for the day. So that's how you do that, Howard. Thanks for asking. I love the opportunity to bring out my new toy and play with it, so thank you. Guys, if any of any others who have questions for Jim, please feel free to type them into the chat box. Ron, I'm not sure. Did you meant to say inalienable? I think you might have got spell corrected.
Alienable, right?
No, the password is not OTAD. OTAD just stands for one trade a day. Ron was saying inalienable.
If you want to send the charts over, I'll go through a crude chart real quick here, and that way we can look at some white bar setups and answer any questions.
Sounds like a deal. Okay, there you go. It's all yours now. Let's see what other questions might be in here. Constitution says, endowed by their creator, with unalienable rights. Okay, Ron, I see where you had typed that before. Yes, absolutely.
Which screen do you see, Dwayne?
I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 charts.
Okay. Let's see if I can bring the crude over, and we'll just go through crude. That's where we did the majority of trades today, was on crude.
Bart had commented earlier, as a science major and medical student, that snake oil potion that Carson lectures on for a lot of money has never been vetted by the scientific method, peer review, etc., all the things he had to do to practice medicine. I'm not really sure, Bart, 100%. Now, Bart is a former law enforcement person as well, Jim.
Okay.
I don't know, Bart, I'm not sure I understand that. If you can, as a science major and medical student, that snake oil potion that Carson lectures on for a lot of money has never been vetted. Oh, so you're saying he lectures on stuff that's never been vetted by the scientific community. You know, I don't know anything about, you know, what he lectures on or... So I can't, we did have, I don't know if you were tuned in last week, Jim, but on Friday we had someone in the audience. They did not want their name used, but they personally knew Carson. They said Carson had opened up their son's head 6 times as a surgeon, and that he was a man who could not be trusted.
Really?
I read it verbatim, and I honored his request not to use his name. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, then maybe there is some truth to it. I don't know.
Well, yeah. So. I mean, I wish the gentleman would have felt comfortable letting me use his name, but he said no, and so I honored that. Bart's got a question for you. When you set up your white bars in the data box, do you only change the trigger and make no changes to the numdevs down and numdevs up?
No, the numdevs down, devs up, and the trigger should all be the same. So when you put that trigger setting on there, they're all the same. Now, numdevs down is a negative number, so it'll be negative 0 point, and the rest of them will be positive numbers. But, yeah, you change all three numbers to the same. Okay. If you can see my chart, I'll just kind of go through this kind of quickly. This first trade here, this was a bounce off the BBC with an up close, and I took a long trade here. This was a stop out. This was our first 10-tick stop out as the room got going this morning. This was right at 7:45. We did have a white bar that closed up. It came back 6 ticks, and then it climbed nicely up to the high of the day. So that was a nice runner there on that white bar. And then the white bars got very elusive this morning, so I don't know if it had anything to do with Veterans Day and the banks being closed, but we didn't get another one on crude. Let's see what the time difference was there. So that happened at 8:20, and we didn't get another one until 9:51. So an hour and 30 minutes later, we get another white bar. So the second white bar closes up and gives 5 ticks of profit. It was a break even for me because I went to break even after I got 4 ticks of profit. It took me out of the trade. It did continue up. The next single white bar was an up close. It also offered 5 ticks of profit, so that was a break even as well. As we moved on in the trading, next white bar showed up at 10:30, right at the end of the live trading session. It closed down. It's almost a shooting star, so I knew it would be a good one. So that one ran for 4, 7, 10, 12 ticks on that particular white bar. And then if you continued trading, you did get a white bar at 11:01. It closed up, offered 3 ticks. Depending on where you got in, it offered 3 ticks. And that one would have stopped you out if you didn't get in better than the 3 ticks there.
Okay,
we've got another one that came in with a down close at 12:20. I wasn't trading at 12:20, but that one offered 3 ticks also, then went the other way. So that wouldn't have been a good one. Got another one that closed up at 12:36, offers 7 ticks. So you'd have been able to lock something in on that. And then the last one here is probably the best runner. This was at 12:51, and it closed down at 42.87, and it looks like ran all the way down to the low of the day at 42.62.
So nice.
Those are the white bars that we had on the crude market today.
Okay.
And primarily we're looking at crude and the Russell in our pre-market room. I've got seven markets going. I'll show them to you. I've got the crude. Then I also have bonds, I'll go back to bonds in a second. Bonds, soybeans, gold, the euro, and the ES are the markets that we're looking at. Now, bonds this morning, this was a white bar single down close here on this one, and then it ran for 9 ticks, which is a nice run on bonds.
For bonds, it is 31.25 per tick.
We were clicking back and forth from a 5-tick range to a 2-tick range, so it screwed my white bar data up. But originally, I had a single white bar here with a down close, and I told the guys in the room, if you wanted to go short at 52.06 or 52.07, whichever number you could get, that was a good trade. And that one did. It ran nine ticks before it came back. So that was a nice white bar trade there.
Guys, so, if you want to get a hold of Jim, his email address is jim@cfrn.net. Play nice, ask him for an invitation. You do need to be an active partner. You do need to have 6 months of experience, because he doesn't have the time to train from the ground up. You need to have put some effort forth, and he's going to ask you, have you written your business plan and your trading plan? If you haven't, I suggest you get started, not just to satisfy Jim, but because if you truly want to learn how to trade for a living, the market's not going to just start cutting you checks and stuffing them in your pocket. You got to do the work. And part of the work is writing your business plan, writing your trading plan, and then reaching deep down inside and finding the discipline to follow the plan. Okay? If this were easy, trust me, everybody would do it. Trading is not easy, but it can be simple if you do the work. So
I agree 100%. And in our pre-market trading room, we're only concentrating on CFRN methodologies. So if you come into the room and start talking about, hey, I learned this from TradeStation, or I learned this from, you know, a different program, and I'd like to try to, and I'm going to cut you off pretty quick and be like, nope, what we're doing is CFRN trading. If you want to do some of those other things, I can't help you, because you're not disciplined. You're not trying to learn the system that's been laid out in front of you. So unfortunately, I hope you don't think I'm cold or indifferent to what you're trying to do, but that's not the focus of what this room is for. This room is to help the CFRN members who have got to a stumbling point and can't seem to get the daily consistency that they're looking for, and I'm going to help with that, but I don't want to address other trading methodologies. Quite frankly, I'm not going to be familiar with them, and I don't want to take up time trying to understand that when I'm trying to show the partners that have been with CFRN for a number of months, at least 6 months, where they may be lacking in their understanding of a specific trade. I want to try to help get them over that hump to get them to a level of consistency.
And guess what? That other stuff that you might want to drag in, if it had worked for you, you wouldn't be trying to get into this room. Obviously, whatever you've done so far, you know, maybe you've had some success, maybe you've been on the roller coaster back and forth. Jim is going to focus specifically. He's going to laser focus on one thing specifically. And if you'll get focused on something, and that's really a problem for, I think, all of us, is that, you know, there's so many shiny things in the store. We want to touch them all. We want to pick them up and look at them and play with them. And you got to get serious. If you change your swing every time you step up to bat, you're never going to really know what works and what doesn't work. We all want consistent results from the market. We all want to be consistently profitable traders, but yet we're not consistable in our trading behavior. If you want consistent results, then you have to be consistent in your approach to trading. And that's what Jim's trying to help you with. And I can't thank you enough for having the heart to give back to the community. And guys, based upon how this goes over the next week or two, we may expand it. We may do all kinds of things with it. So those of you that would like, that you meet the qualifications, you want to be a part, send an email to jim@cfrn.net, okay?
And Jim, I'll check with Michael and Dwayne to make sure you're not fudging, to make sure you've been at least a partner for 6 months. So
thank you.
Don't try to trick me.
Hey, man, thanks so much. I really look forward to Wednesdays. Thanks for being here with us today. We got a chance to talk markets. We got a chance to talk politics and religion. We covered a lot of ground. I'll see you next Wednesday.
Sounds good. If you're up early tomorrow, pop into the room and say hello to the guys. And
2 days in a row, I've meant to do that, and things happened, and so maybe tomorrow I will.
Sounds good. Look
all right,
forward
buddy.
To it.
Take care.
I'll talk to everybody next week. Take care. Thanks.
All right. Well, guys, we're going to wrap it up right here, right now. We asked the question at the beginning of the show, is the S&P going to build a leg to the downside? Leg, retrace, leg. Now, when will we know if it really is a leg to the downside? Well, you got two things coming up. You've got this trend line that I drew, and you've got this weekly zone from last week. Tomorrow, I will be posting this week's weekly trading zones on the chart for all the world to see. But the zones go to the partners at 6:15 a.m. every Monday morning. They get an email with their link to the live trading room, password, the weekly trading zones, the link to the partners meeting. That's what you can expect when you become a partner. And so I show the previous week's zones, and if the previous week is doing this good of a job, imagine what this week might do. You might say, well, how could it do any better? That's a pretty good statement. But tomorrow I'll show you this week's zones. We'll talk about them. And I want to remind you that our partners meeting is tomorrow night, Thursday night, 9 p.m. Eastern. If you've been on the free trial this week, you should have received an email that explains how you can become a partner. If you've not received that email, send us an email, support@cfrn.net, or call us at 949-42-EMINI, 949-42-EMINI. Okay. We'll give you the information you need to become a partner and be in that meeting, that closed door meeting, tomorrow night at 9 p.m. Eastern. The next free trade is going to be Thursday, tomorrow. I typed in 11:13. My bad. By the way, this Friday is Friday the 13th. It's also my 32nd or 33rd wedding anniversary. So tomorrow, 11:12, which is my brother's birthday, 11 a.m. Eastern, there'll be a free trade. So if you haven't signed up yet, now, when you sign up for the free trade, tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern, you have to go to cfrn.net free e-mini trades hyphen countdown, okay? You go here first to get registered. Then it's going to point you to another page where you choose your user ID and password. And then that page is going to take you into the countdown area, okay? And then whenever you want to go to the countdown area to see when the next trade will be or what the current trade is, you'll have access. The last free trade that we gave out Sunday night was on the Russell, dropped 18 points. Now, if you traded that from stem to stern, and obviously none of us did, because you don't get out at the exact swing high or swing low, but there was $1,800 of potential per contract. How much does it cost to trade one Russell E-mini contract? $500. $500. How much do we risk? 8 ticks. I'm not making any of that up. Go there, see it for yourself. That is also the truth about trading, right? You won't always like what I tell you, but I'm going to always tell you the truth. Okay, I think I've answered all the questions in the chat box. Again, jim@cfrn.net. If you want to get in there and spend some time with them pre-market, get a hold of him. You must be an active partner. You must have 6 months of experience under your belt. It's not for newcomers. Newcomers, you be in the live trading room. We'll help you. We'll do one-on-one mentoring sessions with you and help you get from where you are to where you want to be. Speaking of personal mentoring sessions, I have one coming up in 8 minutes, and I haven't had a break or lunch or any of that, so I'm going to go. Thank you so much. Oh, if you haven't been out to the Google Plus page to look at the recap video from yesterday, the concierge recap video, or the one trade a day recap video, I highly encourage you to go take a look. And if you want to become a one trade a day, I think we said we're going to call that an OTATer. If you want to be an OTATer, all the information is on this page. Okay, you pick your markets, you pay for your markets, you then print out the form, sign it, date it, circle the markets that you want to trade, scan it, email it back to us or fax it to us. All the information's on that page, including the fax number. And if you do that today, you'll be trading the one trade a day with us tomorrow morning at 10:30 a.m. Eastern. Now, we don't send those trades to you. You log in at eminifuturestrading.com. You'll be provided the password to however many markets you choose. You can choose a minimum of 2 or as many as 8. You'll be given the password. Each market is password protected. The passwords do change every week. Okay? So, with that, I'm going to bid you adieu. Thanks so much for tuning in. Whoever you are, wherever you are, may God continue to richly bless you with His mercy and with His grace. And I'll see you at the bell.
Remember this, there is no greater return on investment than to see a human life changed and given hope. As always, pray hard and trade safe. Any financial information discussed on this show is simply the opinion of our host, Dwayne Reeves, his co-hosts, and guests. To learn more about trading E-mini futures or to take a 1 week free trial in our live trading room, call 1-866-928-3310. 866-928-3310. Information discussed on this radio program should not be construed as a recommendation to buy or sell any security. Always do your own due diligence and consult with a licensed securities broker or financial planner before making any investment decision.
Hello and welcome to the Mind of a Trader. This is Steve Croft. I hope that we can share maybe a thought or an idea that can have an impact on the